Jeyna manzana na naim rebeya shikili lumong yediana. Malay nay, malay nay, malay nay, bronande, bidonde, rushopo, yikate, haha. Malaya, shiaro, mondeo, siato, irea, sepeo, tokoya. Manaya la majea. Let me just tell you something, people. If you participate with sorrow, you're going to be sad. If you participate with joy, you are going to be glad. And it's always so easy to step over into the realms of that which the Holy Spirit is doing. All you have to do is be happy. One of the names of the Holy Ghost is oil of gladness. That's one of his name, not oil of sadness, because I think many people have misunderstood. Oil of gladness. And there is a world around us, there is a system around us, a demonic influence around us that would oppress and try to sway our emotions and sway our feelings and sway those things ultimately that we feel in our attitude. But if we just make up our mind, I can't hear you, son. If we just make up our mind that we're going to obey God and that we're going to be glad because we're the redeemed of the Lord and we have returned. Yes. People make it so mystical. They make it so esoteric. They make it like they're waiting for God. I'm going to tell you right now, you'll wait for God for the rest of your life and you'll die waiting for God with that kind of a position. The only way that you're going to move into the realms of the Holy Ghost is you just begin to accept. You receive. You go ahead and you receive what he's given. You just receive it. You believe what he said, and you receive what he said. If you would do a study of the four Gospels, you would discover that those two words are constantly being paired up together. And what will it take? Ha ha. What will it take? Well, one of the things is you're going to have to quit finding any kind of rest and comfort and joy within the realms of the spirit of this world and start finding all that you have need of in the realms of the spirit of the Holy Ghost. There is a spirit, there is fruits of the spirit of the world, and there's the fruits of the spirit of God. And Father has demanded that you and I begin to walk in the Holy Ghost, that we live in the spirit. If we would live in the spirit, we would also move with the spirit. Hallelujah. And somebody said, oh, I wish I knew what the Holy Ghost was doing. I've got some good news for you. I know what he's doing, so I can tell you. And when I tell you, the bigger question is, will you do it? That means that you're going to get happy when the guy's shaking his fist at you driving down the highway because he's wanting to get in down the road and you're in his way. Or whatever else that's going on in your life. Maybe you're disappointed. Maybe you're discouraged. Maybe you're overwhelmed. Maybe you're thinking you ought to be doing more than you're doing. Well, I can help you get into doing more than you're doing. All you got to do is start participating and start with what God, the Holy Ghost, is doing. Start doing what he's doing. And Father's going to say, I got myself a man. Or he's going to say, I got myself a woman. I got somebody who's going to do what I'm doing. Do you know how easy it is to feel the overwhelming glory of Father no matter what you're going through? It's so easy. All you got to do is start rejoicing. All you got to do is start getting glad. You just start saying, thank you, Lord, for your goodness. Oh, yeah, yeah. No. You do this and you do this and all the stuff that's going on in the world around you won't be so exciting and fascinating to you that you capitulate your power with God and begin to somehow embrace all of that nonsense. Look, the sorrow and sighing flees away the moment you embrace who the redeemed of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just praise God for all these instruments up here and I'm just looking forward to them all getting tuned up and working. Hallelujah. To where you just get raptured away in God's glory. Where you just begin to become almost. You begin to get raptured around it. And now you're no longer earthly, but heavenly. And now you're no longer functioning in the earthly realm out of human knowledge, but you're now functioning in the heavenly realm out of spirit knowledge. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. I'm going to just tell you, people, I'm going to give you a news flash. The things that are going on in heaven is far more exciting than the things going on in the earth. I got another news flash that nobody seems to know. What God's doing is far more exciting than what the world is doing. I got some more like this too. I have some more, because once you believe it and then you receive it, receiving means you do it. Receiving means you just step out and you just go and you just do it. You just, hallelujah. Harabo de Jeko ta yete no hurushipo. Hella bon de rasito. Hale Monday pa. It means things like raising your hands when you worship. Didn't that just take a lightning bolt from heaven for that to happen? You know, it really didn't. It really didn't, did it? It really didn't, did it? It really didn't. And of course, I know I'm just talking to people on the web, because there's nobody in here that needs this instruction, because you've all matured spiritually into a realm that you already know that just lifting your hands takes you into the glory zone. Hey, it looks like a plug anyways, doesn't it? You know what I'm saying? It looks like a plug, doesn't it? Hallelujah. Well, you know, God says it's something far more than just plugging in. He says the lifting of our hands is like the evening and the morning sacrifice. It is really supposed to be a place of just total yieldedness to Him, to where that your life is just voluntarily a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. Hallelujah. Parabolishayapa. Aramende. Listen, I want to see some people get raised up with enough anointing and participation with God that you can go out and make a difference in the nation around you, because that's what you're supposed to be doing. But until you start participating on a consistent basis, it's not going to ever happen. I'm going to tell you right now, it'll be a dream, mark my words, that will never come to pass. Oh yeah. You know what? I'm very glad that all of you showed up here tonight. I'm very sad for all the people that didn't show up here tonight. If everybody that's supposed to be in this ministry, that it claims to be in this ministry, that's watching by web and that's within the regional area, were here tonight, there would be no room for everybody. And so you've got to understand that there is a press against you. Just keep your hands raised, because you'll receive this a lot better with your hands raised and worshiping the Lord. There is a press against the church of the Lord Jesus Christ with every possible effort that Satan has to shut down the glory, to shut down those who would move in the anointing from moving in the anointing. And somebody's going to have to get themselves some ferociousness, man. Hallelujah. Just beside a couple of people, you know, leave all the work to a few. We'll just sit back here and relax and let the enemy take over. My goodness gracious, who wants to do that? You want to be walking in the glory, praise God. And you know, people, I'm going to tell you right now, if somebody tells me they're sad and can't get out of it, I'll look at you and say, you know better than that. All you need to do is to start dancing around a little bit and ha-ha. Hallelujah. All you need to do is start jumping around a little bit. Praise God. Somebody said, well, I'm tired. Well, you start jumping around praising God and you're going to get refreshed. Hallelujah. 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 See, to me, making heaven is more important than anything else. I don't care. Making heaven is more important. I'm not going to be less than the one who makes heaven. And besides that, I'm not intended to just making heaven. I'm going with some gifts. I'm going with some purpose. I'm going with something, having done something, having believed something, having walked out something in God. Hallelujah. Hey, the Lord knows the opposition. He knows what we're up against. And where sin abounds, grace does much more abound. I'm going to tell you where the enemy fights. I'm going to tell you right now, there's a church that the powers of darkness cannot prevail against. Hallelujah. And people are going to have to understand that sorrow and sadness will not be their strength in the day of adversity. And there's nothing about that. Hey, did you hear me? Said joy would be. Good news. Listen, you know what I've discovered? I've discovered the anointing companies the joy, and the joy companies the anointing. Now I'm going to tell you right now, if you just all happy about earthly things, there's going to be no anointing. But when you begin to get happy about heavenly things with all the opposing forces around you, I'm telling you, Papa moves in with divine glory. And then it doesn't take long, and you're overwhelmed with the spirit of praise and thanksgiving. All of a sudden, you know there is a right place in which you can speak to yourself, you can talk to yourself, and it's not a sign of depression. Huh? And loneliness and introvertedness. You speak to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, praising God, singing, making melody in your heart. Somebody said, people don't know this, but your worship's supposed to be about an overflow of the Holy Ghost. I know, you might as well go ahead and get quiet, because I know you don't understand it. You got to think about it for a while. Just go ahead and raise your hands a little bit more. Hallelujah. Come on, baby. Show them how it's done, sweetheart. Hallelujah. That's right. Hallelujah. You can live like that all the time. That's right. Praise God. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, people. The earth, the church, and the earth is waiting to hear the sounds of Holy Ghost praise. Not performance, not religion. Song is turning into nothing but religion. Oh, I got to. I'm on the music team, and I got to have, we got to do some songs. What are we going to do tonight? Oh, my God, I don't know what we're going to do. I mean, somebody come up with something good. No, it is supposed to be the overflow. Hallelujah. Harabotaya. But I'm going to tell you something else. I can sing the oldest song, the ones that's got so much dust over it, man, you basically create a dust storm trying to get cleaned up, dusted off, and be caught away in heaven with it. Hallelujah. 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 Haropokina Shaya. And I'm telling you, I'm just so blessed with the praise in the house, and they're working out the sound and getting the sound right so people aren't, their ears aren't hurting or whatever. Hallelujah. My ears never hurt anyways. I don't even know what that's all about. I think it's just irritableness, to tell you the truth. Hallelujah. You know what I'm saying? People come in, they say this and that thing about the music. It's just irritableness. You need to get over in the joy. Get so drunk in the Holy Ghost, then everything's good. Hallelujah. I guarantee you. Praise God. Hallelujah. What a wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. What a wonderful Savior is He. All He hideth my life in the cleft of His love and shadows me there with His hand. Hallelujah. Jesus, we love you. Jesus, we praise you and we worship you. Can you sing a song to him? Can you just sing a song to him right now? Why don't you just sing a song to him? Why don't you just tell him how much you love him? Oh, Jesus, you're wonderful, so wonderful to me. Just tell him what you want to tell him. I love you, oh God, my King. Hallelujah. Mambanda ramande bereste bedoro shikode le bende. Hallelujah. We'll prando seyorona. Everybody say thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Everybody say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
That right there, that word, that phrase, hallelujah, or praise the Lord. Woo! My. You're gonna be feasting off that for the rest of your life. Hallelujah. Woohoo! Come on. Come on. Come on now. Hallelujah. Come on, wellspring, spring. Come on, rivers flow. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woohoo! Woohoo! Jesus, we praise you, Lord. Woohoo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I just want you to praise till you get happy. I want you to praise till you get drunk. And if you cannot praise until you get happy, get up here. I want to cast that oppressive thing off you. I want you to praise till you get happy, till joy flows, till the river flows, till the wellspring flows. Come on now.
Yeah, why be religious about it? Why wait? Why wait? Why wait?
Woohoo! Woohoo! Basse kita rama man Jesus aterebe yolobo sota. Monde yolobo suti yaraha. Monday alabakusi pariya popri baye mamani shiprobo mamani yandoya.
Woohoo!
Hallelujah!
Woohoo!
Sasotoya!
Sotoyalo!
Suturibakasa! Monday alaboso! Monday alabosi kiyarana asito! Say alamama! Say alamamo sutayo!
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Just go ahead and praise him. Just go ahead and don't stop. I don't see you very drunk yet in the Holy Ghost. Just begin to shout that wonderful name of Jesus. Begin to praise the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Blessed is the name of the Lord! Lord, we praise you, we praise you!
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you, mighty God.
Sukonde raman Jesu to romangeya.
Se to raman jasa to la monsukore de sheep romon bosata. Mendele la mangosi caramon zebre bosuto ku yishala mane on de burusi payananea.
Manalon jusa caramande shidi namborosa.
Hallelujah.
Malanda shara bakise dia robo.
Mandala la bosoto roma
mosekiti ala la bosoto
irama mandeo seto. Ze rujo geo, hallelujah. Ze zo ziro boye.
Let me just tell you this. Do you know why the great outpourings of God, as it were, tarry? Because people allow the enemy of their soul to oppress them and stop the praise and thanksgiving. If the praise and thanksgiving and the shout of rejoicing would continually go forth, there would be none of this stuff. I mean, people are so sick and feeble, they're sitting down during praise right now because the enemy oppresses their lives. They just get overwhelmed by the powers of darkness. They're overwhelmed by the things that would stop praise. It's happening all over. It's happening all over right now. It's happening all over churches all over America, especially in the Western world. Satan can't, he cannot do anything to stop us once the joy and the shout and the praise continues to come up. And that's why the Lord said, don't be stupid, but be wise, understanding how to redeem the times, for the day is our evil. And he tells us, be filled with the Spirit. And out of that comes a praise, singing it, you know. Hallelujah. 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 Be filled with the Spirit. Speak into yourself in psalms and hymns. And spiritual songs. Ha. Hallelujah. 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 Yeah. Mana mana mon jekara. Hallelujah. 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 And ha. And
hallelujah, and by virtue of being filled with the Spirit, that is what happens. And also, when you let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly, hallelujah, same thing happens. All people all burdened down, feeling some kind of oppressive thing, that's just a trick of the enemy. That's just a lying power of darkness. And besides that, those people that have that all burdened down, feel some kind of heaviness or whatever, they never done nothing in the kingdom anyways, because they've already been neutralized. They don't know how to get out into this realm of divine power and grace and begin to let the Word of Christ. Man, when you let the Word of Christ, the exhortations of what God said through His only begotten Son, Jesus, dwell in you, woo, you're going to be happy. Woo, you're going to have praise. You're going to have thanksgiving. Oh, yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's going to produce. It will produce. It will produce. It will produce what the Bible says. Everybody else looks around it and goes, this is weird. Yeah, but those people looking on it and looking around and saying this is weird, they're not doing nothing either. They're not doing nothing. Reality of it is, in their context, they're saying it's weird. But in our context, we're simply obeying what God said is what He wants. It's what He's commissioned us to do. So who's right? The people who are in their own mind and understanding are sitting around going, this is weird and strange, and they're all imprisoned by sorrow and sadness, or the people who's obeying God and rejoicing in joy and gladness. I say the latter, the people who are obeying God, doing what God's Word said, letting the Word of Christ dwell in them richly, and being filled with the Spirit. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Well, it just, I mean, really the bottom line of it is, it's a revolution, because the bottom line of it is, people have become ashamed of God and church and proud of themselves in the football stadium. Shamed of God in church and proud of themselves on the sports field. Shamed of God in church, all sorrow and sad and mad and upset and can't hardly even move around, but yet giving their energy to bodily exercise, which profits little and don't understand nothing or hardly anything about the exercise of godliness, where you and I begin, that is by definition participating with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You will not find one sad angel in the Bible. You will not find one sad day in God's kingdom. Hallelujah. You know, God said that all sorrow and sighing would flee away, but He also said every tear would be wiped away. Huh? And it's supposed to be in earth as it is in heaven. And that's fundamentally talking about our beings, our bodies. And I can prove that
I can prove that linguistically. I can prove that by application and context throughout the Bible, that when you hear things like Father be glorified in this earth, or you hear thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven, it's really talking about our own individual personal response, because we have in these earthen vessels, hallelujah, huhuraya, the ability to walk around and build ourselves up in most holy faith and be continually ever increasing with the increase of God if we will participate with what he's doing. Satan is going to come at you, and he is an imp from hell, and he's going to try to impose upon you things that he has no right to. You listen to me. And you know what a mastic is, don't you? Huh? Masticism, you know what a mastic is, right? Does everybody understand what I'm saying? Well, is it derived from a Greek? I'm glad. It's derived from a Greek word, mastic, and it means scourge or whip. You know the woman with the issue of blood who purposed within herself, saying she didn't ask Jesus permission. It wasn't on his faith. She snuck up and got something from him he didn't even know was it wasn't asked. It was grabbed a hold of. And the Lord finally turned to her and he says, you are cured from your mastic, your whip, your scourge. It's literally what it means. I know King James and others translated it different. I think there's a few translations. Green's literal translated it scourge. Where you're a scourging at the whipping post, being whipped. You are delivered from your, cured from your whip. That's what Satan does. He whips. He's a taskmaster. He opposes people. He puts upon them sorrow and sighing and pain and torment and affliction. Oh, thank God for Jesus. Thank God for Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank God for Jesus, the Savior. Hallelujah. The one who's come, our Redeemer, who came, delivered us from hell. Hallelujah. Delivered us from the power of darkness. Hey, it's torment in darkness. You'll gnash your teeth. There's gnawing a tongue and gnashing of teeth in darkness. Dentists are saying they're making more teeth guards for people than ever before because they grind their teeth at night. That sounds like gnashing of teeth in hell right there, right now, at this very moment. People go, they go wake up in the morning, half their teeth are gone. Well, not half. But I mean, you know, after a while, you know, they had nice, big, fat, thick teeth. And after a while, man, it's down to about half the size. Unless they get one of these teeth guards because they're so oppressed. I'm not going to be oppressed. See, I understand the fruits of the Spirit, and I understand the fruits of this world. I understand the fruits of the Spirit of God, and I understand. Listen, you don't have to be a genius to get this. Good news, eh? Praise God, huh, Mike? You don't have to be a genius. Anna got this. Babies can get this. There is this fruits of the Spirit of God, and there's the fruits of the Spirit of the world. The Lord clearly identifies the fruits of the Spirit of God and tells us to walk in the Spirit, to live in the Spirit, to move with the Spirit. And that's just a simple act of our own will to say, okay, I'm going to do it. God says, rejoice always. I'm going to rejoice always. People talk about, let's obey the word. Come on, let's get her done. That's what we're talking about over here. Quit walking around like your best that God died. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I see people. I wonder, I get to church, I wonder, are they going to be happy or sad tonight? You know, and then if you got to count on them for anything, my goodness gracious. You know, it's a peril. Praise God, we count on the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. And he gives us long suffering and patience with people so that we can begin to continue to minister to them. Because if people will just hear the simplicity of doing this, they'll hear the simplicity of doing it. And it sounds foolish, I know. But the wisdom of God is foolishness to men. It is. It can't be understood by men. It's just foolishness. It's just foolishness. Don't make any sense. Huh? Don't make any sense at all. Huh? But let Norman Vincent Peale come along, talk about something right out of hell, something demonic, and everybody's all up in arms and excited about it. Let God just start talking about the simplicity of being happy, praise God, and rejoicing in the Lord, and dancing, hallelujah, hallelujah. Building yourself up in a most holy, in most holy faith, and everybody's all, you know, unimpressed. Well, that certainly can't work. Yeah, because it's going to take some work on your part because you're so used to being depressed.
with a duh, not a D. Are you? A couple of you got it. Praise God. Hallelujah. God wants to give you spirit knowledge. Let me tell you about spirit knowledge. Spirit knowledge will speak to the rock and water will come out. It will say to the moon and the sun, stand still and it will obey. Spirit knowledge will tell you to be happy. Yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Spirit knowledge will tell you that you're supposed to be happy and rejoice and full of thanksgiving. This is the will of God concerning you in Christ Jesus. Then all things, you in some things, when it's all working the way you predicted it to work, when it's all going like you feel it should go, because, I mean, why? People say, well, we really want that orthodoxy. We want just like God said in His Word. Good. But the hearers are not justified. The doers. Don't just believe. You have to receive it. In other words, you have to go with it. You have to just go ahead and begin to operate in it. Hallelujah. I got so many things I'd like to minister to you tonight, but I'm going to minister those things most needful. I'm going to minister those things that are going to change you. I'm ministering by the Holy Ghost those things which are absolutely essential. And I pray that you receive from God the Holy Ghost tonight and that you will not be hearers only, but you will do them. You will implement them. You'll implement them with greater passion than anything you've done in this life. And if you will, and it's because I'm going to give you the Word of God, I'm going to give you the B-I-B-L-E just like it is written. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And if you do these things, if you do them, you will be justified. And in that state of justification, you have everything available to you that is from heaven. And now as you begin to give yourself to them, as you begin to exercise godliness, as you begin to give yourself to the things of the Spirit, guess what happens? You grow. You grow and you mature and it becomes a flow that is easy. That is easy. Hallelujah. I mean, I've seen power of God come on people and they just can't even hardly find the English language for weeks on end. Can't hardly find joy for weeks. I mean, nothing but joy for weeks on end. And then all of a sudden, you know, it begins to subside a little bit, that glory. And instead of passionately pursuing it, they just sit down and say, oh, no. Because now it's up to them to obey God and step out. And they just act like somehow it's all gone. God visited for a while, and who knows when He's coming back. People, that's bad theology. He's come with us. He's with us. You know, parakletos comes from two Greek words. It's exactly the parakletos is actually a Greek word that is very difficult to translate because there's not a lot of etymology. There's not a lot of history, linguistics history on it. But what we call parakleion, okay, parakleion, or paraklein, is a either form, is a very exact word. Most of the time it's translated exhortation or to comfort. But I find it most often in context found to mean to plead with, to plead. Parakleion, to plead. Listen to me. That is the description of who the Holy Ghost is. He's pleading with us. Would you guys just get happy? Yes. Would you guys just rejoice? Would you guys just get thankful? Because if you would, Satan wouldn't have a chance. If you would, God would be found. You would find a participation with the one who is with you and in you. Because see, we want the Holy Ghost to do sad. We want to feel the manifest presence of the Lord in sad. He don't do sad. He's never done sad in all eternity. And He's never going to do sad and sorrowful in all the future in the future. Eternity. He's doing joy and rejoicing and gladness. And when we begin to agree with God, when we begin to do what it is He's doing, suddenly we begin to find a manifest glory and presence and an increase with the Father that people just don't get. I know it because I've said these things for 32 years and 34 years. I've been pastoring 34 years. How many are older than 34 here? Raise your hand. Okay, put them down. How many of you here younger than 34 years old? Raise your hand. Okay, there we go. Okay, I've been doing this for 34 years, and very few people have the ability to get it because everybody is so wise and prudent. And the Lord needs himself some simple, hallelujah, to simple, like babes. Oh, this is all we got to do. Right, hallelujah. But what if it gets tough? Well, all the rejoicing while it was easy got you strengthened enough to be able to do it when it's tough, because then that's where the big breakthroughs happen, praise God. But if you have been doing your homework and participating and being happy when it's a good time, my goodness, what are you going to do in the hard times? If you dragging your feet when you're just when the crew's just walking around, what are you going to do when it's time to keep up with the horses? Anybody had to grab a tail and try to run along the side of the horses? Well, you know, you're going to faint quick. You're going to faint quick unless you've been keeping up. Hallelujah. Huh? I still cannot keep up with my wife running. When she opens up, I'm always telling her, please, baby, don't embarrass me today. Would you please? Can I set the pace? And you know what she does? She's so gracious. She lets me. Hallelujah. But I'm getting ready. I'm getting back in shape. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Poco rashing laipai. Halamondera. Especially in the things of the Spirit. Amen. Well, you could be seated for a little while. Hallelujah. Tokane yapurishikane butane. Son, I know you need your babysitting tonight. Your wife took the meeting off. Don't do that. Don't prioritize the meetings. I don't care how much money it's worth. Okay, you hear me? You keep God's house first. You hear me? Okay, just keep God's house first. I don't care how much money you're going to make, how big the deals are, just keep God's house first. Praise God. God bless you. Amen. Hallelujah. Keep God's house first at all times in everything. Praise the Lord. I'm going to give you a bunch of verses of scripture tonight. You know, what I do is I'm constantly allowing God the Holy Ghost to reevaluate things in my life. And I know that I'll get up here and I'll start just, you know, I'll just start quoting scripture, and everybody just listens to it, and it's somewhat fascinating hearing me quote scripture one after another. And I know the anointing's captivating enough so that you're entertained the whole time, huh? But I don't know how much people retain these things, and I don't know how many people are really desperate and hungry, go back and listen to the YouTubes over and over and over again. And praise God that we have them on YouTube. And I know that some of you do. I mean, I've gotten some things from people. I've gotten information from some folks where they're just like, you know what, I've listened to this one YouTube. I've listened to this one tape, you know, I mean, just a huge number of times. And that's good, because, and you want to do that. If you believe, I mean, I tell you right now, we just fill ourselves up with the Word and the revelation of the Word. We want to hear what God the Holy Ghost says. The Holy Spirit unveils the Word. And we keep the Word on. We keep, you know, we got some favorite people who read the Word. And I'm sure you do too. And we just keep the Word on. We got the Word everywhere, the Bible everywhere. We're hearing it. We're getting in it, Word into us, because it's Spirit and life. It's Spirit knowledge. It changes everything about our perception, perspective of things. We don't try to understand the world based upon what everybody around us is saying. We don't try to understand the world based upon events. I'm not interested in trying to understand the world based upon a plummeting stock market, huh? Everybody's fear selling, and they're concerned that they're going to go to panic selling. It doesn't mean anything to me. I wonder what Father's got to say. Hallelujah. Praise God. I don't have any money in the stock market anyways. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Don't trust in uncertain riches. People is going to disappoint you. These are terrible times to trust in uncertain riches. Amen. And so just go with God. He wants to show us, he wants to bless us. He wants to show us great things. Hallelujah. He wants to cause us to inherit all those things which he possesses. And he's looking for some stewards, some people who are going to keep his stuff first, so that he can entrust you with more. And I'm telling you, especially the true riches. Are you with me? I'm after some true riches. I'm not after temporal riches. I'm after the true riches. Jesus, who was rich, became poor for our sake, that through his poverty we might be made rich. Those are the riches that I'm interested in. He's blessed us with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly place. That's what I'm interested in. Holy Ghost is here supplying them. He's not left anyone out. No one can get, for you to get into some kind of rut and believe that somehow God has left you out, it's just absolutely a crazy demonic lie. He's poured out his spirit upon all flesh. He's left no one out. He's called all men to salvation. Anybody who will listen, whosoever will believe, everybody gets to participate with these things. They're for everyone, anyone. All you've got to do, you're going to have to say no to the world. You're going to have to say no to all your gods. When I'm in, especially when I'm in, a Hindu country, I know how Hindus are. Another god, they'll take another god. And Buddhists really, you know, Hindus have 33 million gods. Buddhists really have more. I mean, they don't say they do, but they really do, because Buddhists really are animist. And they believe that everything is a living god, is an expression of God, and has some kind of, you know, some kind of future in it, you know. Blades of grass, leaves on trees. I mean, that mounts up. That starts adding up. You know what I'm saying? Flowers, petals on flowers. It keeps on going, on going, and going, and going. But when I'm with Hindus especially, if I start talking about Jesus, I know what they're going to do. They'll take Jesus. Yeah, hara, hara, Krishna, Krishna. And bring him in too. I mean, you know what I'm saying? They'll bring him with, they'll set him there with Kali and everybody else. Are you with me? And so I make them, or I tell them, I tell them, you want Jesus? Then you're going to have to repeat after me. Say this. Say, I tell them, you don't need to say this. I tell them, you say this. All the gods I believed in are demons. Hallelujah. And the Hindus are getting this. Are the former Hindi, they're not Hindi anymore. They've been brought into a new race. Hallelujah. There's a new race. Hallelujah. God's brought forth a new race through Christ Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I had a dear woman up here. She just recently from Sri Lanka. And I said, you know, say it. You know, say your sister-in-law, all the gods are demons that you've been serving. Praise God. She did it. She said it. That's huge. I renounce all of them as demons. Because otherwise, you are getting nowhere. And there's a lot of gods in the Western world that are far more subtle. And you're holding on to them with both hands. And I mean, you've got them piled up in your pockets. You got them underneath your arms. And you're saying, Jesus. And it's hard to lift your hands. Because if you lift your hands, they're going to all fall out. You got all these gods attached to you, all these things that you put your trust in, all these things that you value, all these things that prioritize Christ Jesus, all these things that cause you to renounce God. You literally commit treason against them and run after sin and lust and pleasure. Listen, people become lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. What is that? That's idolatry. That's by definition idolatry. It's just modern idolatry. And I really want to help you understand how good it is to walk with God. I'm going to tell you right now, heaven's forever and so is hell. And people say, well, I can't believe a loving God's going to send me to hell. You send yourself to hell. People send themselves to hell on a daily basis by the decisions they make. There ain't nobody's going to make a decision to live in pain and sorrow and sadness. It's simply the consequence of your decision. But what God has given us the opportunity to do is make the right decisions, and we can step in to the oil of joy. We can step into joy in Him forevermore. We can step in the goodness of God and the blessings of the Lord and live out days of heaven upon the earth instead of living out days of hell. It's your choice. People believe whatever they're going to believe. People say, well, I don't believe that. Well, fine. It's your choice. How is that working for you, what you do believe? How is that working out for you? Is that the result you want? Is that the consequence you want? Is that what you want forever? Because I'm telling you, you're making decisions. You better weigh the value of it and the results and the fruit that it's producing in your life. Father has described to us the blessing and the fruit of life that would be produced in our life simply by obedience. He tells us that everybody is dead in their trespasses and sins until they're made alive by the power of the living God. He makes it very clear to us that Satan will oppose upon us out of his tyranny everything that belongs to sin and sickness and disease and darkness and torment and depression of the mind and depression of the spirit. Everything that is evil, that is ugly, and that is ungodly that people look around and they see in the world every day. I was sitting by an atheist on the airplane the other day talking to him for 2.5 hours, and I couldn't believe what I was hearing. The guy supposedly was an engineer. I have my doubts. He's supposedly an engineer. If he is an engineer, he has got really a very poor ability to be logical. Because he's telling me that men are getting better. overall, men are now less evil than they were. And I'm like, what bubble are you living in? I mean, give me a break. What on earth? What did you have before you got on the airplane, man? I mean, you're on some kind of a trip here. I'm serious. It's just crazy nonsense. And it was just an example of demonic power deceiving people. There is so much wickedness right here in this nation. There is so much peril all around us. Listen, it's the consequence of sin. And Father's opened up a door for us to be able to step in to a heavenly realm, communicate, fellowship with Him, live in this abundance, live free from sin, live free from sickness, live free from disease, live free from torment. And we just want to go ahead and do it our own way, believe in our own way. Huh. You know, I love just thinking about, I'm not going to minister on this tonight, but I love thinking about the woman with the issue of blood. She's spent all that she had, and she didn't benefit from it. The scripture says she grew all the worse. And she heard about Jesus. I don't know how she heard about Jesus, but somebody came along and I'm sure testified about how they were blind or deaf or something, and she had hope. And then all of a sudden she heard another person, and then she's got more than hope. Man, I need to find this Jesus. And then somebody comes along and tells her something else. And she goes, if I can just touch his garment, all I need to do is just touch his garment. She did not ask him permission. She didn't ask him, if it be thy will. She didn't ask him nothing. She took him totally by surprise. She came fearful and trembling and bowed herself before him when he discovered that somebody had laid hold on of him and power had came out of her, and she was completely and totally healed. She said, when they said, all I got to do is touch him, all I got to do is touch his garment. And she came in the back of the cow and she touched his garment. Power went out of him. It was not even his. He didn't even volunteer to participate in the prayer, in the healing. She laid hold on him and made a demand upon God, hallelujah. And Jesus looked around because he felt power go out of him. He said, who touched me? And the disciples said, are you kidding? The crowd presses upon you. He says, someone touched my garment. Are you kidding? Somebody touched me. Are you kidding? Look at the crowds pressing on you. I'm sure there was a bunch of people wanting to be healed that day. There was a bunch of people wanting attention from him. But there was a woman who had faith. And he turns to her. He says, woman, your faith has made you whole. Where did she get that? Was it just her desperation? Was it just the intensity of what she was going through? And all of a sudden she heard a rumor concerning Christ Jesus that there was a place where that she could get help. And she saw the evidence of that help. And she knew that he was no respecter of persons, because somebody said, you should have seen the love in his eyes. You should have heard the gentleness in his voice. You should have heard the welcoming of his cry. I'm telling you, she had her built up in her. She knew what she was going to get before she got there. And I want you to be able to have the same kind of confidence. I want you to have at least, if you can't get it from people around you, and there are many testimonies in this place, if you can't get it from people that are gifted by the Holy Ghost to describe it, go to the Word and look at what God has done for so many people in every generation and recognize that He's no respecter of person. And what He's done for one, He'll do for anyone who's going to believe, who's going to lay hold on Him. People, all, if it be thy will, it is God's will. It is God's will. And look, there's no one who describes it more than a woman who doesn't even involve God in the decision. She did not involve God in the decision. She looked around and said, who touched me? And said, are you kidding? They're pressing against you from all sides. No, someone touched my garment. She knew it. And he looked around looking for her, the scripture says. And she knew she couldn't be hid. She came fear, trembling, bowed down before him, said, it was me. He said, woman, your faith has made you whole. Because she knew immediately in her body that she was made whole. That the blood had, the fountain of her blood that was continually flowing out of her that had made her so weak and so pale, was dried up instantly, touching him. I want you to believe that what God has described in his word is available to you. It's yours. It's not a fairy tale. It's not fictional Christianity. I can't help it a bunch of religion came along and spoiled you. I can't help it that the philosophies and traditions of men made you a rotten egg. I mean, come on. Praise God for the miracle. Hallelujah. He'll make you a new egg. Hallelujah. Praise God. He will. He'll work a miracle. And that's why Paul said you'd be spoiled by traditions, by the philosophies of men. who basically want to train you and conform you to the rudiments of the world. They're speaking to you out of the rudiments of the world, out of the logic of the world. The logismos is a Greek word, the logismos, the logics, or what is translated in 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 5 as imagination, something that you're going to have to throw down, cast down. Because I'm going to tell you right now, those logics, those rational thinking, when it comes to trying to place God within the box of logic, rational thinking, you're going to have some logic and rational thinking to drive home. Are you listening to me? But when it comes to interacting with God, you have to understand there's a whole nother realm here. It's a whole nother level of thinking. It's the mind of Christ. It's the mind of the Spirit. It's spirit knowledge. It's the kind of knowledge that can speak to the rock and water's going to come out. Say to the moon and the sun, stand still and it will obey you. To say to an axe head float, to say to flour and oil, do not diminish. Do you want best spirit knowledge? It's available to you, and it's going to be fashioned and formed in you in the very simplest ways, and it's going to be something about rejoicing and joy and getting all that sorrow and all that complaint and all that murmuring, all that accusation and all that torment out of your life and say, look, I'm not going to have it anymore. I'm not going to be under the scourge of Satan anymore, because I'm going to tell you right now, he will run right over top of you if you don't know your authority. He's an imp. And he has gotten a certain latitude in which he's allowed to operate, and he will impose and afflict upon you and afflict you with things that he has no right to do. Amen. And then if you're going to make it, if it be thy will, then he's going to laugh his way right over the top of you as he puts upon you everything that he can within that limitation that God, and that restraint which God will put on him. As for me, I'm not letting no demon power do anything. Amen. Starting with sin and iniquity, hallelujah, and move right on into the rest of the program. Okay, so I'm going to lay some heavy on you here, okay? You ready?
Yeah. Yeah.
And so I'm going to try to start light and work my way up, okay? So just turn in your Bibles, 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 7, and I want to just talk to you about diligence. I want to talk to you about a passionate pursuit for excellent. I'm going to tell you that God over and over again uses words like fervency, diligence, passion. There is a condemnation against lukewarmness, slothfulness, procrastination. People procrastinate stuff all the time. They're going to do it. They're going to get to it later. Tomorrow. No, today. God is a today God, a now God. Do it now. And he's commanded us to be full of zeal and passion and purpose and determination and diligence and consistency and faithfulness. These are, listen to me. These are the things which Father demands. And so I want you to listen to this. Therefore, as you abound in everything, in faith and utterance and knowledge. Isn't that you? Am I talking about you? You're just abounding. You're abounding in everything that belongs to faith, in the utterance gifts, in the knowledge gifts, in all diligence. See, this is what the Holy Ghost supplies to us. He's supplying to us all this passionate pursuit of that which Father said is ours that has to be developed. It came to us for free, but you and I have to recognize that it's very sacred, it's very costly, and it's something that we are going to participate with and give ourselves to wholeheartedly. Otherwise, it will never be developed and it will never mature in our life. We'll just be on hold. But if you get radical about God and you make the things that the Spirit of the Lord has made available more important to you than academics, more important to you than business and all the other earthly pursuits of your individual interest, and all of a sudden you say, wait a minute, God has made me an heir and a co-inheritor with him. He's given me all the gifts of the Spirit. They're made available to me. He's given me this all power and ability in Christ Jesus. He's given me the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. I mean, I could go on and on. He's given me all grace that I might have all sufficiency and all things. I mean, come on. It's just this is how God talks to us. And we're sitting around, my goodness, too busy working for what? Slave wages. Slave wages. Slave wages. Slave. You make $250,000 a year. That's just a drop in the bucket. I mean, how can you even live off that? And then most people don't even make that. They live below poverty. Huh? And they all stressed out about it because they put their trust in man. They put their trust in uncertain riches. They made the flesh their strength. They made the arm of flesh their strength. And then God says, cursed is the man. Not because he's cursing them, but because there is a curse to live such a way as that. The only way out of it is to put your trust in the arm of the Father. To put your, make him the sole object of your trust, as Jeremiah said in Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 7. Listen to me. I'm telling you, this is hard to get into because it's going to scare you to death. You're going to risk everything. It's going to be everything different and opposed. Listen to me. It's everything opposed to what you've been taught since a child. You were fashioned by a Western culture in a Western caste system with a bunch of Western lies that is opposed to the knowledge and the wisdom of God. And that, I'm going to have to cast down that logical, rational thinking, and you're going to have to bring into captivity every thought into the knowledge of God. The knowledge of God. See, people understand, you know, there was a long time Pentecostal church had a real problem with the concept of the gift of the word of knowledge. They didn't understand it because that verse phrase is only used one time in the Bible. The words of knowledge is used twice in the Bible in Proverbs, okay? So if you include the plural, it's used a total of three times in the Bible. But hundreds of times, the knowledge of God is used. The knowledge of God comes to us by way of the Word of God. His Word is spirit and life. It works mightily in those that believe. We're supposed to live on it better than we can live on bread. It gives to us an insight that we may know the holy. It gives to us the understanding of what God is doing. If we'll cooperate with it, it will produce supernatural, miraculous, divine power kind of faith, because faith comes by hearing the word. If we just begin to participate with the word, God the Holy Ghost will unveil the word to us, and by virtue of living by the word, you're living in the mind of Christ, the knowledge of God. Listen to me, you're living in the wisdom of God. When the Spirit of the Lord came upon men of old, like when Moses laid his hands upon Joshua, you know what came upon him? Spirit of wisdom. It was the spirit of wisdom that was able to say to the son of the men, stand still. Don't move till I'm not done yet. Yeah, I still need the light. I don't need to, you know, they have a bunch of people getting to say and think, well, you know, I just get a bunch of people and they can all light the lanterns and, you know, turn on the candles and, you know, whatever. Give me a break. He's not even talking or thinking in a logical realm. He's got wisdom now to think in the insight of the realms of the Spirit. His eyes have been opened. See, the servant of Elijah, his eyes needed to be opened because there was a Syrian army that had come out against him, and there were tens of thousands of them. And he said, how are we going to do? There's only two of us up against 10,000 of them. And he's like, where do you get your boldness from, prophet? The prophet got his boldness because his eyes were open. He had the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of God. He had spirit knowledge. He was able to see into the realm that everybody else's eyes were shut. Man, I'm going to tell you right now, you know how to get yourself some faith, get yourself an encounter, all of a sudden have your eyes open. The servant of the prophet suddenly has got faith bigger than the prophet. He's like, hey, man, yeah, I feel sorry for all of those guys because his eyes were open and he saw the angel of the Lord and the chariot thereof. He said, wait a minute, there's a whole lot more going on around here than what I knew before. He said, all the heavens are filled, all the earthly realm is filled with the glory of God. Listen, believe it or not, heaven and earth is filled with his glory right now. Right at this very moment. It says, I don't see that because you look at it wrong. You're looking on that which is seen. You're looking in the realm of that which men, evil men are working and operating. The church is being more influenced by the world than the world is by the church. As soon as we shut that thing down and we're not influenced by the world anymore, the tables will be turned and suddenly the world will be more influenced by the church than the church is by the world. And the tables got to be turned. But that is a decision that is going to happen in each individual's heart. It's not something that God is going to do. He's already done it. He's poured out his glory without measure. He's given to us an unlimited divine power and ability to function in this, but we're going to have to believe and we're going to have to start participating on a level that seems foolish, like getting up in the morning and dancing around and laughing and praising God until you get filled with the Holy Ghost. And then ultimately get to the church where you actually raise your hands the whole time in the meeting. Praise God. And then something else begins to happen and you begin to understand a transition from an earthly realm into a heavenly realm. And no longer you run the risk of setting your affections on earthly things. And you're going to have earthly results. You, as a born-again believer, you run the risk of setting your affections on things of this earth and not on things above. God's called us, and he said, if you've been risen with Christ, do not set your affections on things of this earth. Set your affections on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. And what does that mean? When he was seated at the right hand of God, we were seated together with him in that same place, Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 6. What did he do? He received the promise of the Father when he was seated there. And he poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost that we see in Acts chapter 2. Last few words Jesus said, Acts 1:5. Remember what John said, you baptized with water, you're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now. Acts 1:8, you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. Then you can be one of those who provide proof of my resurrection, that I'm alive right now instead of being dead. Hallelujah. That I have all power and authority. Then on the day of Pentecost, suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind clothed in tongues of fire came, rested upon each one of them, and they all began to speak with other languages with the tongues of heaven, hallelujah, as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. Praise the name of the living God. The new tongues. These signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They cast out devils and speak with new tongues. Tongues that have never been heard before. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Like the writing on the wall during the days of the grandson of King Nebuchadnezzar, right? The writing on the wall, hallelujah, that nobody could understand, a heavenly language, like telethakumi, which being interpreted means maiden, which being interpreted means, and he said, maiden, arise. Somebody said, it's Aramaic. I said, oh yeah? Where? Show me how. Oh, well, maybe it's not Aramaic. Maybe it's a. No, you can't find the root of that anywhere in linguistic study. It's telethakumi, right out of Kasupotaramakaya. And it's one of the few phrases anywhere in the Bible that needed to be interpreted. You know why? Because there's no way to translate it. Right. What is this? Telethakumi. It's takasomoki. Lapatanameshe. Mahatikanino tapahaya. It's spirit talk. It's spirit talk. And I can find it over and again. People who've got their tongue set on fire of heaven don't have their tongue set on fire of hell. Huh? If their tongues aren't set on fire of heaven, then you can hear what all they're saying about everybody running everything down and the anointing gets the worst end of it. Anybody who's threatening the devil and the powers of darkness and preaching God's word are going to get run down by that fiery tongue set on fire by hell. Are you listening to me? Than anyone else. Huh? You talk better about the rank, ungodly, wicked man than you will about the righteous man who stands speaking God's word and pursuing the lost and dying world and the revival of the church. We pursuing the revival of the church, and the Lord has caused me to understand. I started singing the other day a song that's just, you know, that is a psalm, and I began to just sing it. When the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, we were as them that drink. Then was our mouth filled with laughter and our tongue with singing. Then said they among the heathen, the Lord has done great things for them. And I began to sing it like that, singing a couple of times, because the Lord just encouraging me of what's about to happen through the people who've been standing and not backing down and not bending, huh, or bowing to all the music of the world and the threats of the enemy. Hallelujah. You watch what's going to happen. A captivity is going to be returned. Somebody said, we've not been in captivity. Oh, yeah? I'm going to tell you right now, it's measurable. It's measurable captivity. But praise God that there's people who've had a prevailing prayer, an interceding prayer. And the preacher, pastor's wife, where I was at, she said, the Lord just gave me that verse of scripture for the first of the year. I was crying out, seeking God, and that's what the Lord said to me. And, you know, I'm telling people, you just need to be encouraged. But you want to be cultivating what God has called us to cultivate and be cooperating with the Holy Ghost instead of going with the demon spirits, huh? The unholy ghost, unholy spirit. Instead of all the things that of imaginations of your mind and all the things that have been imposed upon you. Somebody said, my dad treated me bad. Listen, big deal. That person is dead and buried, and now a new person has been raised up with a new dad. Get to know your new dad. He's the greatest dad. He's Father in heaven. And forget about the former conversation, living back in that prison. My goodness gracious. Hello. I mean, come on. Are you dead or alive? Which one are you? Come on. I mean, people just need to start saying, you know, you need it on a daily basis. If you can't remember, say it over and again. You'll get on to it before too long and it become part of you. I'm crucified with Christ. Hallelujah. I'm buried with him by baptism into his death. Hallelujah. Praise God. I'm raised up together with him. And by the way, you got to die before you can get raised. Hallelujah. Huh? Some people are dying, and that's why they look like they're dying. And it's been a very poor testimony of a risen Savior. Hallelujah. But we're alive together with him. Hallelujah. when we raise, who are alive together with and seated together with him in the heavenly realm. A heavenly realm of authority. That's why Paul said, you know, Paul's the same one that's talked about in, that we were seated with him in the heavenly realm of authority, both in Ephesians 1:2 and Ephesians 2:6, because he also declared in that perspective that right now, that same authority that he has and he functioned in as the Son, we now function in that same authority as matured sons, not like children that differ nothing from a servant. Of course, that's the message that he gave in Galatians chapter 4, 1 through 7. Powerful, powerful passage of scripture that people have been unwilling to lay hold on. And it's very simple. It's written in second grade English. Second grade, all you need is a second grade education to get that one. Maybe third, but I think second grade will do it. But yet we don't get it. Why? Because the spirit knowledge is too high for us because we're our affections on earthly things. I'm not, somebody said, oh, he's talking down to us. No, I'm trying to talk up to you over here. Hallelujah. I'm trying to help you understand how to step up into a glory realm that has been provided for us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mando se kaya, prosang de apalani. Well, look what the spirit of the Lord's given us. We all excited about utterance and knowledge, but diligence. I want you to get rid of your slothfulness. I want you to get rid of your procrastination. I want you to stop delaying, waiting, give God the last few minutes of the week. Huh? Then you're late on that. Huh? It's like the preacher up on the platform. Oh, God, give me a word. Oh, God, give me a word. Oh, God, give me a word. Because he's going to have to preach. And the Lord said, the Lord gave him word. You lazy. So all he's got to preach on is how lazy he is. Up at the last minute trying to get something from heaven. My goodness gracious. Huh? Your affections are things set upon things of the earth. You've got to recognize that and turn it around. You either got to recognize it and turn it around or recognize it and say, you know what, I like the earth better than heaven. Be honest with yourself and say, oh God, I like earth better than heaven. And I ask you, Lord, to cause me to have a change of heart. I know I'm ignorant. I want some wisdom. I know I'm stupid. I'd like to have some insight. And if you got honest with God, he's going to do something for you. Hallelujah. People who love evil and don't love righteousness, he doesn't even be honest with God and say, you know, God, I'm just going to let you know, I love evil. I think it's better than righteousness. But I know you say in your word that we're supposed to hate evil and love righteousness. I don't. And I know that it's my problem and my issue, and I ask you to give me wisdom and insight, turn this thing around. Because people just go on and pretend. They try to cover their sin. They try to hide it like Adam did. And act like, and then nothing's going to change. Get honest with God. I don't think you could halfway get through that sentence in seriousness and still hold your head up. I'd rather you get broken before God just being honest. And everything would change inside of a minute. Because God's just that way. He's a miracle worker, does things in a moment, instant twinkling of an eye. Hallelujah. Purasto paranea past. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hamaneste. Hamaneste pora. Hamaneste pia. Loko yasi. Makia shaponanai. Hallelujah. Jamesia, hallelujah. Kapasteriti, the kaneshika, rupoti, mea shiporanai, hallelujah, hallelujah, ha ha ha, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Kana moshe riata, hallelujah. Mandeshe, I threw a little Hindi in there. Hallelujah, ha ha ha, praise God. As poranaya sambokerine, praying amasi tolomo, enestineneki. I had almost raced to Bodori, almost lost me. Oh, uh-oh. I'd almost lost the English language. I lost the English language the other night. I was trying to say something, and it was over. I just had to sit down. But at any rate, I'm just a Karenashi Lana Mongadayana going on. And a missionary was from Africa, was in the meeting. He said, he comes to me, we've known him most of our life. I've known him, his family, his dad was a mentor to my father. That was back long ago, obviously. And he said, Mark, when did you learn how to speak Swahili? I said, man, I didn't. I said, that was just pure Holy Ghost, what all was being said. And it was beautiful to find out what all was being said. And so the Lord does sometimes barostekine totapari with elana mosik, the tongues of men. Hallelujah. And it's happened in my life more than one time. Huh. May stick on the bar. I was one time speaking Arabic. And I wish I could have kept that because Arabic is so hard to learn. And Arabic's a person born his first tongue in his Arabic, and he comes to me and he says, man, this is what you were saying. And he was just so deeply touched by it. The preacher was preaching. I'm speaking in Arabic while he's preaching. Hallelujah. Father wants to do supernatural things around us that will strike us with awe. You know, and I'm going to say this in Mark chapter 5. When they woke Jesus up, they expected Jesus was going to do something about the storm, about the violent wind. They had no expectation he was going to do what he did. And when he did what he did, the scripture said they were afraid with great fear. They were afraid with great fear. It's not because they didn't, and they said one another, what manner of man is this? It wasn't because they didn't believe in who he was. It's just they never encountered this level of glory. Huh? It's like Job putting his hand over his mouth with a greater encounter and saying, I'm never speaking again. It's like Isaiah saying, woe is me, with a greater encounter. Father's got a greater encounter. If we're going to pursue him, if we're going to diligently seek him, he's going to reward us, man, with a debasterinaya. Obedience has to go ahead of revelation. Obedience is God retains all right to revelation. The scripture says, Jesus dealing with the disciples after they had been with him for many years, for over 3 years, after they had gone through the trial that they went through during the period of his being, you know, put to death and then raised from the dead, they're on the road to Emmaus, and the scripture says, and he opened up their understanding that they may know the scripture. Hallelujah. They could read it all they want, but they're not going to get it. Not till God gives you revelation, and he's looking to give some people some revelation. He's looking to give some people some spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, that their eyes may be opened, that they may see what his inheritance is in us. See, I can understand that the other way around, what my inheritance is in him. But God's got inheritance in you. And I'm telling you, if I begin to just talk about that tonight, for me, that is one of my favorite messages to preach, because there is a long list of what God has in expectation to bring forth through your life, through that supernatural communion and that supernatural covenant and that oneness that he's produced in our life, both in this world right now and also in the world to come. There are many souls on the inside of you. There are many, many giftings on the inside of you that God has an inheritance there that was purchased by Christ Jesus, transferred to us by the Holy Ghost. Jesus said, everything that the Father has, he said, he will transmit it to you. Hallelujah. And he said, everything that belongs to the Father is mine. He'll transmit it. On people, we just are limited. We're held back because our own human understanding can't go beyond that certain degree of acceptance of the supernatural, of the divine power, of the glory, the miraculous. And every time it does, it's a fearful and a frightening thing, but it is a great breakthrough. They had a great breakthrough that day when they're looking at each other going, what manner of man is it? They knew he was going to get up and do something. They didn't realize that he was going to just walk over and say, silence! Be still! Both to the wind and to the water. And all of a sudden there comes this great calm. Immediately. Now he literally says to the wind, stop! And to the waves, silence! Be still. And it wasn't fascinating, it wasn't marvel, it was scary, it was frightful, it was fearful. They were exceedingly fearful with great fear. That's a literal translation. Oh, I want to encounter the Lord tonight like that. I'm in pursuit of something real. I have tasted and I have encountered and I have had many encounters that I can talk to you tonight that has resulted in where I'm at right now in God. And I'm desperate for more encounters because it's there in that place that as we encounter more. People, I'm going to tell you right now, you will stop being unfruitful. You will stop being locked down doing whatever it is that you normally do with your life with an encounter, a little bit more of an encounter with God. You'll run to the nations. You'll have faith and authority to cast out devils. Suddenly you'll begin to bring in the fruit of the lost. It will happen. It will happen. You will have a platform. I'm going to tell you right now, Father's eyes go to and fro throughout the earth and looking for anyone, and he's not picky. And as soon as he can find somebody who's going to trust him like Abraham trust him. And really, in that context, is just trust him like Asa. Because that address was to the King Asa, who really just trusted God, didn't even trust God half a fraction of what Abraham trusted him. Are you listening to me? Yeah. People, I'm telling you right now, it goes on and on. We can talk about Jehoshaphat. We can talk about so many different people. I mean, what if you're up against an army that's just, it's not possible for you to defeat them by any natural means? You send for the prophet. What are we going to do? Is there someone we can send for? Is there help that we can call on? Is there weapons that we can design? Is there a way for you to do some signs, wonders, and miracles for us so that we can possibly be successful and not be wiped out this day? And the prophet says, yeah, I've got it for you. Ready? You're going to go out and face your worst nightmare. You're going out, and people, I'm going to tell you right now, you're sitting here in a comfort zone, and you're just like barely, you know, awake. But I'm telling you right now, this is going out, and somebody's going to kill you. They're going to torture you. They're going to poke out your eyes. They're going to cut you up. That kind of day, okay? Before the day is over, they're going to fillet you. Huh? And the prophet says, what you're going to do today is you're going to lay down your shield, and you're going to lay down your sword, and you can go out worship. You tell me we can go out and sing a song to the enemy and that's how we're going to defeat him? Are you kidding me? Next. This can't be the word of the Lord. We got to get at least two witnesses on this over here. How do we know you're a real prophet? People, God is always doing the same thing to you and me, and we're constantly running for the hills and asking for another prophet. And going, gong, next. We're doing it. We're just not aware of what we're saying. We're not aware of the decision-making process. I want to wake you up. I want to shake you till I wake you up. I'm going to shake you till I wake you. I'm going to tell you right now, God is moving by His Spirit in the church today to wake up somebody that can be awoken from the sleep. Yeah. It's true. It's true. And then you just start looking at the decisions you're making. You're going to go, gulp. I'm a coward. I'm a fraud. I'm fake. Huh? I'm going to change. God, come strengthen me. I want to be real. I'm tired of being a poser, a pretender. Father, I want to start moving in reality. I want to go big or go home. I'm ready, Father, to move with you. Hallelujah. Come on now. It's time. I understand it's the mercy of God that comes to give revelation. But I'm going to tell you right now, He's come to give revelation to anybody who wants to receive. And there is a posture. There is a state of the heart that hooks up with God. Obedience before revelation. You simply obey God. God had come with a certain amount of revelation and introduced to us our opportunity to be saved, to be born again, to be changed by the Spirit of the Lord. When we obey, ooh, boy, this is good. Now we're starting to get something. We're like feeling this now. Well, the same way it continues on. And having begun in the Holy Ghost, we're now made perfect. We grow and we mature by the same Holy Spirit. And I'm going to tell you right now, it's conceited legalism that believes that they can do anything to please God outside of the Holy Ghost. It's conceited, arrogant legalism. They believe that they can, that is the true definition of legalism, to believe that you can do anything that please God without the Holy Ghost. That's true legalism. You understand me? Yeah. All these other definitions of legalism, nonsense. It's not biblical definitions. God's definition, it comes right down to an allegory that everybody can see, an Ishmael and an Isaac. Huh? That which is of the flesh, of human ability, and that which is of the Spirit, that which God can do. It's not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. It goes all the way through the Bible. It's a theme that runs all the way through the Bible. You know, Paul set forth the thesis for which all his writings and all of his epistles, which make up 2/3 of the New Testament, is centered on. Galatians 1:16. See, he had a revelation of Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus. He saw Jesus, but then God revealed something. Though that revelation of Christ Jesus was amazing and beyond all spectacular, suddenly the Lord showed him something even more unbelievable, unimaginable, that he had purposed to reveal Christ Jesus, his son, in him. And immediately he conferred not with flesh and blood, but went into Arabia for 3 years. And there was made known to him abundance of revelation. Come on now. And now all that he describes about the new creation, the new man, all he describes about the faith of Jesus Christ is all centered around Christ Jesus, his son, being revealed in us. And to believe this, to believe what Christ Jesus said in John chapter 1, verse 12, 14, where he said, as many as would believe, he gave them the authority to be sons of God, as many as would receive him. to believe and to receive. Believe and receive. Go ahead. Look at it. It's a theme that runs all the way through the New Testament. And especially if you do your word search on the Greek equivalent words, okay, rather than the English equivalent words. I mean, you're going to find those two coupled up together. And people, it really comes right down to hearing and doing. That's really all it is. It's just another way of saying hearing it, and now doing it. Hallelujah. And doing it in such a way that nothing can turn you back. I mean, because there's people that are going to stand before the Lord and he's going to say, look how hard you labored for your car. Look how passionate you were about your mortgage. Look how determined you were for your own stuff. But when it came to moving and risking everything for me, it just really didn't happen very often. When you are risking everything for you and always one day. There's too many people said they're going to create finances for the kingdom of God, and they died. And their finances and their wealth and their riches went to earthly concerns and earthly pursuits and even to being squandered and spent, on the big roll of the dice in Las Vegas. Always a good intent, always a passion, but never God knowledge, not spirit knowledge, not doing it the way the Father wants to do it. Father doesn't need money to propagate his kingdom. He needs people to take a hold of the one who owns all things. He'll resource you and me, I'm telling you right now. I used to tell my wife, baby, you know, you're supposed to be independently wealthy, so this and that and the other thing. And then one day I said, forgive me. Basically, I recognized, wait, you are independently wealthy. Whatever you need, you just ask it and it's yours. It's deposited in your account. Huh? When you step into that, because otherwise it's just kind of like, oh, that's fun. You know, that's pretty cool to think about. Tomorrow I'm going to get up and go to work. Are you going to be done pretty quick? Did you hear everything I just said?
Yes.
Because it's not a revelation.
Right.
Huh? It's like, oh, no, how are we going to do here? Because look how many there are of them and there's only two of us. But now my eyes are open. I see that the world around me is filled with the forces of heaven. With the army of God. Hallelujah. And more than that, I'll tell you right now, I'll take the Holy Ghost against 10 billion angels any day. If I had to choose, I can have either 10 trillion angels or I can have God the Holy Ghost. I'm going, God the Holy Ghost. Because he done create all them. He can do far more than, come on. Yes. If one angel can slay 150,000 plus men, come on, what can the Holy Ghost do? I mean, the people, my enemies haven't got a chance. Yes. He's with me and in me. And he's pleading with me. He's pleading. My parakletos is parakleon, me saying, pleading with me, would you please agree? Would you just get happy? Would you dance around and rejoice? Would you give thanks? Would you just praise in the midst of all of that so you can hook up with an anointing that breaks off the yoke, so that you can hook up with an anointing that will produce a faith? You'll speak to the rock and water will come out. You'll make a walkway out of a sea. Hallelujah. They'll say to a sycamine tree, puck up, plant in the, over here in the ocean and produce me some money. Hallelujah. Anything. Oh, sita meokaya. Don't waste your life on thinking with your head. Don't waste your life on working it out in your little pea brain, as Grandpa said. Don't try to waste your life doing it by your own strength and power when God has vested an opportunity where we can move in his anointing, his glory, his word, his authority. Come on, people. All you got to do is get over your little self, because God's taking care of the demons. All you got to do is get over you, because he will empower you to be strong in his strength and his power. I mean, you have to pursue this. This has to be something that is a daily going after it. It's a second by second, minute by minute, hour by hour, day by day. People just have whole protracted times where they don't even think about these things, where they just allow whatever wants to run through their life. And it's not met with any Holy Ghost resistance. It's not met with any Word of God resistance. It's not met with any diligence or any determination. It's got to change. If you want to step into what God has for you, it's got to change. Hallelujah. This is a battlefield, brother, not a recreation room. It's a fight, not a game. Hallelujah. Be like Saul's army or be like David. It's your choice. There was tens of thousands. The tens of thousands of mighty men were there. But there's only one little David. the tens of thousands of men with their great power, with their great strength, with their swords, with their exploits, with their campfire stories about in the day, and you should have been there when. It was one David. So what is he saying? How can this guy do this? How can somebody threaten the people of the Most High God? What's wrong with you people? Are you guys nuts? I'm going to go down there and kill him. I'm going to take his head. Huh? He stands there. You come with sword and shield. I see something different. I come with the authority of Almighty God. I come by the name of the Lord. You come with sword and shield. You come with your strength. I come with the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. I come with the name of the Most High God. This day I shall take your head from off your shoulders, and I shall feed your flesh to the fowl of the air and to the beast of the field. Come on now. Well, come on. Come on, people. Come on now. Come on. We've been born of the same spirit, given the same kind of heart. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God said, I'm going to find myself a servant after my own heart. God went and found himself a servant and created his own heart in him, just like he did with Saul. And he did so with us. But Saul, we can make a choice to start doing it in our own way and trust in ourselves. And then what we will do is we will corrupt, we will pollute, we will defile a mind that was the mind of Christ, a mind that was the mind of the Spirit, like, and give ourselves over to defilement, just and be, because we were seduced, we were beguiled, just as the serpent beguiled Eve from our simplicity in Christ. And with corrupt minds now, huh? We try to go on as though nothing's happened. 2 Corinthians 11:3. People are going to have to be diligent. You're going to have to be diligent. I'm not going to go to 2 Corinthians 11:3. I was just giving you the quote that I just made. Hebrews 11:6. Everybody knows it. It is impossible to please God without faith. And you know, Paul says the same thing, and really just says a different way in Romans 8:9. He says, they that are in the flesh cannot please God. Look at all the people running around bragging about how they're in the flesh, and they just can't help it. Are you in the flesh or in the spirit? Man, would you get your terminology right? Would you get your biblical terminology right? That which is of the flesh is flesh. And God says it cannot come into the kingdom. It cannot know God. This is what Jesus is saying. You must be born again. And when you're born again, you're of the Spirit, because that which is of the Spirit is Spirit. All Paul is doing in Romans 8:9 is just taking the theme of John 3:3-6 and making it very definite in his explanation of who we are right now in Christ Jesus. How are you going to have that? By your works of righteousness? No, because you are going to agree with God, and everything that opposes that knowledge, you're going to beat it up and cast it down. You're going to throw it down. You're going to bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. You're going to grab hold of the knowledge of God and bring every thought into the obedience of Christ. Amen. Yes. Amen. Well, listen, don't worry. You've got the Holy Ghost to help you do it and give you insight. And the more you obey, the more insight you get. And the more you lay hold on the saying, the more God is right there, freed, as it were, given permission, as it were, to stop all this harassment. Because he's not going to transgress our will. Praise God. I wish he would. Sometimes I say, please transgress my will, oh God, please. I don't want to have my own will. He said, no, you got to voluntarily give it up. And you're going to have to voluntarily give it up when you most want to use it. Let me say that again. You got to voluntarily give up your will when you most want to use it. Amen. Ah. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Why don't you just go ahead and say, I'm living to do the will of the Father. And now just have that where you no longer have the right to choose. You're going to do what God said you're supposed to do. And now that's going to take care of those times when you're tempted to go ahead and use your will to do something other than what pleases Father. You listening to me? Man, I'm telling you right now, Father calls us to walk in his statutes and keep his charge and keep his commandments, because that's the new covenant. That's what the prophet said over and over again. And that's why Father's written his word upon our mind, upon our hearts, so that we would do them. Yep. Hebrews 8:10, 16. I'm not turning there. I'm just giving you the quote. I'm trying better. I'm trying to quote more or give you the reference of the scriptures that I'm quoting. I just want to help you. I'm always looking for another way. Well, it didn't work that way. Let me come at it from this way. Well, it didn't work that way. Let me come at it from behind. Now I'll come from the top. Okay, now I'm going to go from the bottom. I'm going to get at you. One way or the other, I'm going to get you. I'm going to get you into this. I'm going to get you so into this. You say, I'm in. I want you to be more in. Huh? I'm in. I want to be more in. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Exploits. Praise God. Yes. This is how it's done. And so he says, without faith, it's impossible to please God. For they that come to God must believe that he exists. Not just is. Say, they that come to God must believe that he is. Say that. Now say, he is.
He is.
And he's here. Oh, now you're on it. Now you're on it. Now you're on it. I've been in situations where I was going to have to minister. There were people with great expectation telling how all the things and supernatural things are going to happen. It's already getting ready to happen. And I'm sitting there about to fall off to sleep because I'm so tired, right? Huh? And all I did was say, he is and he's here. And as soon as I did, I got quickened. Because that's all it takes. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, I've sowed a lot of life, my life in it. I've sowed. If you sow to the things of the Spirit, you're going to reap everlasting life, or the God kind of life, or the Spirit kind of life. Remember, Jesus personifies eternal life, right? For the life was manifested unto us, and we show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. 1 John chapter 1, that's verse 3, right? Jesus personified as the eternal life, the life of God, the life of the Spirit. All we got to do is begin to participate with him. I'm telling you right now, hallelujah, when you begin to say he is and he's here, because you could say he is, but he's a long ways off. He is, but I don't know if he's going to help me right now. He is, but who knows whether he can see what's going on at this very moment. But when you say he is and he's here, now you recognize, now you're agreeing with God. Hallelujah. God's just looking for someone to agree with him. And you're saying, I know that you're here. You're with me and in me. That's what you promised to do. And you're not a liar that you should lie. You're not one who's going to be unfaithful, but you're faithful. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Say he is and he's here. And he's here. And he is a rewarder of, here's that word, that does not procrastinate, that is not slothful, does that not wait till later, going to get around to it sometime, and it's always too late to get her done. It's like the guy constantly waits. He waits, he waits, he waits. He knows he needs to get the crop in, but he waits, he waits, he waits. He finally says, well, I've got to get it in now, and then 3 weeks later, the frost comes. Because that's what's going to happen every time you procrastinate. That's what's going to happen every time you delay. That's going to happen because you just leave it to whenever, when you can get to it. You know you need to get to it, but you do not have a regimented, disciplined life. That is the only value that I see in school and education. I put my kids through school and education. You know, poor Joshua. Praise God, he's almost got it now. We already calling him Doc, but they put you through the grind. You know, just like protracted. You get the wrong advisor and like another year for your PhD. But you know what's there? It's discipline. It's regimentation. It's making. You've got deadlines. You've got to meet them. There is something set before you that's going to train you how to live a life that if you'll apply it to the things of the Spirit is going to have a great reward. People just constantly just letting things go. Your closet, the way your closet looks, tells a lot about your spiritual life. You walk in your closet, look how organized it is. Get in people's car, look at all the trash you got to move out of the way, huh? You feel like you need to take a bath when you get out of the car. This speaks a lot of your life, your discipline. You listen to me now, huh? I made up my mind a long time ago. If anybody tried to get in somebody's car and you got to move trash out of it, you got to feel like you got to call the dump truck before you can get in, or the trash man before you get in. I'm not getting in. I'm just going to walk away. See, I'll take a cab. Where are we meeting at? Give me the address. Now, people need to learn. They need to be rebuked. You need to look at the stuff that's going on in your life, that's keeping, that is evident token that there's not diligence there, that there's not a passionate pursuit. Because if it's one area, it's another area. And if it's in the natural, it's going to be in the spiritual. And if it's in the spiritual, it's going to be in the natural. Praise God. Hallelujah. Get yourself pulled together. Huh? And the Malasateya Mahaya. Anybody that's like that, raise your hand. Now take that same hand and slap yourself. He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. It's all connected. I don't know where I come up with this stuff. Hallelujah. Praise God. I'm going to go to Ocean Springs. I'm going to go preach in Ocean Springs. You guys hear about that? April 24th, 25th, 26th, I think it is. Or is it
They think they're watching. Sorry if I said the dates wrong. Don't change the dates. Whatever I said. It's right. It's like the 27th, 28th, something like that. But anyway, 3 days, I'm going to go preach there. I'm going to see the power of God move in that place.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Because we're going to be in Tuscaloosa, Alabama on the 22nd. Then we're going to be in Jackson, Georgia on the 29th. And I didn't want to have to fly back. So I said, I'm going to call over there and tell them, and I'm going to come. If you want me to come, and they're like all excited about it. Praise God, they watch us, Pastor, there at the Assemblies of God. They watch us constantly on the web. We love them so much. And, we praise God for all the ministries and all the people in different places. We had 159 nations out of 196, out of 196, 158 or 159? 159 nations. 159 nations. Why are you shaking your head? No, you just don't remember? 159 nations out of 196. Tune in last year. 30,000 people. I mean, that is amazing to be able to do that. And I just praise God over and again for the web ministry. And there's a lot of other people that do the same, the streaming web ministry and then the YouTube ministry. Thank you, guys. Thank you. And let's just go after it at another level of excellence, which is going to take a lot of diligence. And then ultimately what's going to happen is when we can now stand right here and preach to the masses. It's like I was just with him. I just preached at a brother's church. His dad really started Christian television because he got a vision. He was a gang member with Nicky Cruz, Brother Ortiz, and Brother Clark Ortiz, and he went around everywhere, and he set up satellites and set up reception antennas all over churches. Bought and just learned how to do it. God gave him understanding. He basically, built TBN Dish. Dish was Christian before it became what it is now. From all the things that they were able to do. I mean, that great legacy. I mean, it's just so wonderful. What is that? It's a great diligence. It's a passionate pursuit of excellence. And when you begin to do that, and he said, so one time somebody said to him, said, would you come and do a crusade? He said, why should I do a crusade? Go and do a crusade. When I can stand in my underwear with a shirt on in front of a camera and reach millions of people. Good point. Good point. Hallelujah. All I got to do is comb my hair and my boxers. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Because they're not seeing anything from only the waist up. Praise God. And I can reach millions of people. Listen, people, God's got creative ideas for people who want to be used by Him. I want you to grab a hold of it. I don't believe that there's any one person who's a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ should be doing slave wages for somebody, some evil man that is going to use the money for corrupt purposes. All God's people should be able to have businesses without it turning their hearts away from the things of the kingdom of God. God will give you a business that you only have to work half-time at instead of having to work full-time. Work half-time, make 10 times more money. I'm telling you, that's just the way God does it. That's the way He does it. But people are going to have to start moving in the realm of faith. There's a lot of diligence that's going to have to be a part of that. There's a lot of choices and decision making of keeping God first and getting out of a mentality that limits you and getting over into spirit knowledge where there is an unlimited opportunity. Oh, yeah. And there's a few people really listen to me. Huh? Whoop, 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 whoop. And that's what they do on that Peanuts thing, Charlie Brown. You know, anytime the teacher's talking, it's whoop, 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 whoop. In the name of Jesus, I bind that evil thing.
Amen.
Just going to sit and listen. Oh, imagine. Oh, wouldn't that be nice? Come on, people. Where are the valiants? Come on now.
Amen.
Where are the people going to rise up and do something with the Word of God instead of sitting around hearing about it? Huh? Huh? You cogitate, you're going to get shot. Standing out here in the open cogitating. You better take cover. You better do something. You just have to move out with what God's given you. Otherwise, you're going to delay and delay and delay and delay. And that's the opposite of diligence. I'm telling you, God's not into lukewarmness. He's not into laziness. He's not into slothfulness. He's not into delay. He's not into apathy. That is a demonic ploy to stop you from ever being what God called you to be. You have to step out in faith and risk everything. Hallelujah. But with it all, too, I'm going to say this. I know that God has purposed that people step into a realm where business starts serving ministry rather than ministry serving business. We've had it all backwards. Satan has done the Antichrist thing. He's flipped it all around, over and again. It's about time business starts serving ministry. Amen. Where all your business is really an activity that reaches a loss. Where all your business is really an activity not only to make money but advances the kingdom of God. That's business serving ministry, see?
instead of you wasting your whole time, all day, your day is consumed and making enough money so you can take care of your mortgage and your car payment, and you're a modernized slave under a system of terrible debauchery and slavery and tyranny even. And now you break free of that by this wonderful privilege that God has given us by the Spirit. Hallelujah. My. Hallelujah. And every turn in the road and every action of your life and every energy that is put forth into the things that ultimately God uses to create finances and create wealth is also an activity of reaching the lost. Amen. It's ready right now in heaven, right now. I'm doing it right now. I'll show you a model of it. You come look at me. Come on, man. Somebody said, well, you just did that. Yeah, I just did that. Well, how did you get there? I stepped out in faith. Because I could sit there and look longingly at the glory just like you are, wishing that one day would come. Or you just get up, rise up, and believe God. Amen. And change everything.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
People, I understand. It kind of makes you sick to your stomach. It's fearful. Listen, I'm telling you right now, I'm going to tell you, listen to me. People get addicted to stuff. Huh? And it will become uncomfortable to get rid of it. I'm going to tell you right now, you could be addicted to watching television. And if you had to get rid of your television, you'd get sick to your stomach and lose all your peace. It's true. Your mind will play tricks on you. Huh? Yeah. I don't talk anymore about that because if I get going down that trail, I won't finish what I'm doing, but we could shake that out. We'll shake that bush later. Amen. Because some of you need it shaken. Now, look real quickly with me in Hebrews 12:15. The Lord says, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. Paul said, the grace of God wasn't bestowed upon me in vain. Look, think about the grace of God that has been given you. What are you doing with it? Because it's going to set precedence of whether God's going to give you anything else. You say, I'm stuck. Yeah, you're stuck because you're not moving out with what God gave you. You better look diligently lest you find yourself not fully utilizing the capacity that Father's already given you, because when you do, Father's going to give you more. If you're faithful in a few things, He's going to give you more. Paul said, I wasn't unfaithful. The grace of God wasn't bestowed upon me in vain. I labored more than them all, but not me. It was the grace of God given to me. It was God at work, the grace here on the inside of me, that I ran with it. Now we need to look diligently concerning these things, making sure that we're doing what God's called us to do with this wonderful thing that God's placed within our life, this wonderful treasure that we have in these earthen vessels, the Holy Ghost, the excellency of His glory and of His power in us. Now think about this, lest a root of bitterness spring up in any of you. Because that's what's going to happen with a bunch of idleness. Huh? About you not doing what God called you to do, you're going to get irritable. You're going to get irritable. You're going to cause problems. And that's what it says. Root of bitterness rises, springs up on the inside of you, you just become a troublemaker. It's for me to get down on my face before God and cry out to Him, build myself up in my most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, and begin with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit to begin to pray for the people in the church, in the community, in the nation, and in the nations of the earth. And it's not just for me to sit around and play, you know, whatever spiritual little games with. Come on. You know, because ultimately what will happen by application of this verse of Scripture, it had turned into the sound of brass and tinkling cymbal. And that's just obnoxious. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Porosana e perineashi. Hallelujah. Say kanamoshe. Say kanamoshe. Say kanamoshe. Tinanama. 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 Somebody says, try and teach us how to speak in tongues. No, I want you to enjoy what I'm enjoying. Tinanama. Hallelujah. Pokorinashi. Halema. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I laid hands. I saw said the supernatural happened the other day. It's a beautiful supernatural thing. I learned later that many people had laid hands on this guy and received baptism of the Holy Ghost, and there was no reception. I laid my hands on him, and it just come bursting out of him a very matured expression of the Holy Ghost. It would have been bottled up in him so long.
Hallelujah. Praise God.
Oh, it's wonderful. The sabernia, the paranamorti, the participation with the Holy Ghost. What is the Holy Ghost doing? Do it with them. That's where you'll grow. That's where you'll mature as you exercise. And it starts with joy, praise, thanksgiving. God, the Holy Ghost is doing it. If I could just get you to do it, if I could just get that insight imparted to you. Hallelujah. Then all things you're supposed to give thanks, that you're supposed to be exceeding glad in all your tribulation, that you're supposed to count it all joy. Hallelujah. And I can go on over 560 times the Lord said stuff like this. And we're going, huh? 560 times. Huh? And then we want to talk about, you know, if I'm, you know, he doesn't provide for his own, he's worse than an infidel, and divide the faith. One verse of scripture, 560 times. We're going to be so obedient to that one verse of scripture. 560 times God talks about joy, we're not doing anything with it. There's some problems here. I think that the, you know, this part about over here, you know, being diligent in business and doing your stuff, you know, take care of your own, I think that that kind of has more synergy with the way people are living. That fits in better. You can accommodate that better. I want you to get rid of that.
Yes.
Hallelujah. God will show you how to properly take care of your family.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Amen. Without it absorbing all your time and prioritizing the kingdom of God. God wants whatever you do, God wants kingdom of God to be first. Amen. Kingdom of God has got to be bigger in it. Otherwise, you're going to have to go through all kinds of problems. Poor you. It's true.
Yes, it is.
It's true. We rejoice with our joy unspeakable, having received the end of our salvation, though now if need be, we're in tribulation, many temptation. Huh? That the trying of our faith, which is much more precious than gold, our faith needs to be tried.
Yes.
We're in heaviness because of many different trials and tribulations, because it's needed till our faith gets like, huh?
Gold.
Pure refined gold that's for his, that's unto his praise and honor and glory that is coming. I want that. So we don't want you going through no more problems. We want you to get the kingdom first. Quit acting like, you know, that M word. That's right. Moru, which is the Greek word for fool, which is which the derivative, Arabic derivative of moron. And everybody wants to be further called a fool than a moron, or stupid rather than a fool. But they really all mean the same thing. And the Lord said, contrast that with wise. He says, don't be a moron, be wise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, people don't want to believe that that's what it says in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 17, 18, 19, but it does say that. And I don't want to be that, and you don't want to be that, so just go ahead and be filled with the Spirit. Be wise. Be filled with the Spirit. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Scripture says, whew, hallelujah. And, you know, I love this particular verse of Scripture that I'm going to give you right now, 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5. I'm sorry, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 5. Because it's in the context of the Lord has given us everything by His divine power that we need. Huh? According to His divine power, He's given us everything that pertains unto life and godliness. Because He's called us to glory and virtue. That's the first verse. That means He's given us everything we need to do what He's called us to be and do. Now, he says in verse 5, now, in light of that, give all diligence. Look at this. And besides giving all diligence, he says, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge. And he goes through the list. And think about, this is the diligent application. I'm going after this. The Lord's called me to come and learn of Him, to walk in lowliness and meekness, to come to understand that there's more than just 9 fruits of the Spirit. There's about 27 of them. Praise God for the short little abbreviated form in Galatians chapter 5, verse 23. But God has given us the call to come and learn of Him. He said, that you want to see how this operates? You want to see how the anointing functions? Watch me. I'm a wash feet. I'm be servant of all. I'm meek and I'm lowly. Here's where you're going to find rest in yourself. You're not going to be irritable anymore. You're not going to be aggravated anymore. You're not going to be frustrated anymore. You're not going to be blockaded out of flowing in the greatness of God. Come learn of me. I'm meek and lowly. He says, now there's a diligent application to all of these things, virtue and knowledge and gentleness and meekness and this godliness and this brotherly kindness. I mean, just walking around in goodness all day. God purposed for me to walk around in goodness all day. God purposed for you to walk around in goodness all day. If badness comes, what are you supposed to do with that? Let it run right over top of you like a freight train from hell? No. You're supposed to stand up and say, no, in the name of Jesus. Off the tracks. I mean, you know, you're supposed to stop it.
Yes.
Hello. You don't just capitulate. He's put you in charge. He's made you ambassadors. This is what it means to be an heir of God and co-inheritor with Jesus. You and I, by the divine power of God, can stand up against this stuff and say, no, God has called me to live in goodness all day. I'm going to live in goodness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Huh. When you feel like retaliating, no, God's called me to live in kindness and gentleness. Hallelujah. Give diligence to it. Now look on down at verse 10. I'm going to try to wrap this up for you as quickly as I can. Hallelujah. But I know what the Holy Ghost does. You know, Holy Ghost did, Paul modeled for us what the Holy Ghost does when you start preaching. His preaching is so late, and it really helps give us, encourage us, because if somebody falls asleep in the meeting, you think, well, the anointing must be down. But Paul was fully preaching the gospel with a full power and expression of the anointing. Somebody fell asleep in his meeting. They were in a window. They fell out, fell down dead. This is the way to get a meeting up and going again. Here's how you re-energize a meeting that seems to be slowing down or getting old. He falls down the ground dead. They go down. Everybody turns their attention and starts praying for this guy. I can't wait to meet him, you know. He's known in heaven as the guy who fell asleep and died. And they raised him from the dead. Then they went back up into the room, praise God. And Paul continued to preach until the morning. And then he rose up and went into the next town and village. That's the model. Somebody said, well, we got to get to work. You wrong priority. I understand. I mean, I'm telling you right now, I wake up sometimes in the morning, early in the morning, going to bed late, and I think about your slavery. And I think about the bondage wherewith you have to serve with great rigor and affliction. Yes. I do. And I intercede for it. I said, Lord, some of you, I call you by name, because you start looking really tired on us. I say, Father, strengthen them. Help them to realize that they do not have to continue to do what they're doing. That they can step into a bold faith and begin to live great for you, begin to live big for you, begin to do whatever they could possibly imagine in the divine. I mean, with the knowledge of God, now you can start imagining, hallelujah. You can start dreaming big things in God. You can get a heavenly vision. Amen.
Amen.
That's why people ask me about going to college. Yeah, you can go to college just so long as you're not planning on doing that for the rest of your life. Don't get in debt where you got to now go be a slave and go work. You don't have a choice to serve God. You got to go pay off the bill. I'll find a way to make sure that the bill's paid off. So then you're free when it's done. Because all you go to college for is to learn how to serve God with greater vigor. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Just have more to bring to the master. Here I am, Lord. Use me however you want. Praise the name of Jesus. Come on, man. There's a nation to win. Hallelujah. Verse 10 says, wherefore, brethren, give all diligence to making your calling and election sure. If there's anything we ought to give great passionate pursuit to, and that is what this calling that we have upon our life. It is this privilege that we have to see the giftings of God, the nature of Almighty God, the splendor and the majesty of His nature fully developed and matured in our life, not by our human discipline, but simple cooperation with the Holy Ghost. I want you to get this. I want you to understand it. I want it to imprint upon your heart that you recognize that these are the things that you've got to be tending when you're up against the situation, when you're up against the wall and things are pressing in against you and trying to produce within you a human retaliation or worse. You cry out to God for help. Say, Lord, let your river flow. Lord, let the love. Lord, let the joy. Oh, God, let the peace. That's one thing about the overt expression of joy. With it comes all the rest of the things. I'm going to tell you right now, all comes the love. But if I would start laughing right now, just start laughing. And then the whole Barane, and then the Holy Ghost. I'm just laughing in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Somebody say, you sure that's God? You think too much. I just started laughing in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Joy's not of the devil. Okay. Are you of God? You know, so we just begin to laugh. I don't tell you right now. You would begin to be overwhelmed with the love too and the peace too. Hallelujah. And His presence too. Could you just learn how to do these things? I think medical science has finally caught on. They got cancer patients over there just, you know, somebody got clowns coming in making funny faces, get them to laugh. Because they discovered that there's some real benefits to the physical body if people start laughing. So they've got all kind of jokesters and whatnot coming in.
Hey, we can do, we've got a deep well of joy. We've got rivers of joy. We're doing nothing with it. Don't see the value in it. Don't see any real meaning to it. Well, one thing is going to take the ugly off of you. That's going to greatly help you right there. Hallelujah. Ain't nobody look good. No one's ever looked good frowning. Now, this is kind of crude, but I believe that Hispanics call it poo-poo face, isn't it? I tried to brace you for that one. I thought that was it. When I first heard the Hispanic say that, I go, well, that's pretty good. I'd like to be able to say that in public, but I don't know if I can. That's very descriptive. I'm in trouble now. Wherefore, give all diligence to make you calling an election sure, because if you do these things, you'll never stumble. Think about that. What happens if you begin to give diligence to that which God's called us to do? Give diligence concerning the grace that has been given you. Give diligence concerning this wonderful reward that Father has for you. What did he say? You don't even stumble. That's what he says. Verse 10, look at it. Somebody said, can you tell me how not to stumble? Somebody said, can you tell me how never to fall? I said, I can tell you how never to stumble. Because actually this word is already defined for us in Romans chapter 9, because Romans chapter 9 contrasts the Greek word for fall and the Greek word for stumble. And this is a particular Greek word for stumble. You won't even stub your toe. Hallelujah. Now, much less trip and fall and hurt yourself. Come on. Just give it diligence, saying, I want this all day long, second by second, minute by minute, hour by hour, day by day. Father, I'm interested in you. Father, I want you to use me. I mean, I tell you right now, my wife is around me all the time. She hears what I'm saying all the time. She's a great witness. She's a great sounding board. I got to know that what I'm telling you is always the truth, because I've got someone right here who's going to hold me accountable to it, and also have the Lord who's going to hold me accountable to it. But you'll hear me saying all day, Lord, use us. Use us in a greater way. Lord, we want to be used more by you. And we're not just sitting around twiddling our thumbs, going doing our own thing. Well, we're saying that we're applied to the kingdom of God. Doing it. Behold. Hineni. That's what we're doing right now. In other words, I want you to do it too. God's got things for you to do. And I'm so blessed for those of you who've taken up responsibility in this ministry, that because there are people in here that the meeting can't happen unless they are diligently doing what they're doing. The workers and what people are doing on Sunday mornings with all of the children, all the other things that are going on around here. And there's so much more to do. There's room for so much. There's how many rooms in this place? And they're not all full. I'm just so blessed at what Ruth Ann is doing on Thursday nights and what different ones of you are doing at different times of the week. I mean, you're just going after it. Praise God. And when the anointing's there, people gather around it. Praise the Lord. Huh? And if no one's gathering around it, my goodness, gee, don't worry. Just don't be faithful to God. The anointing will increase. The anointing will increase. The anointing will increase. Be faithful. The anointing will increase. Hallelujah. I got to try to hurry. It's hard for me to do that. But 2 Peter 3:14, quickly. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that you look for such things. And look, we're looking. What are we looking for? We're looking for this wonderful, glorious appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're looking for that day where we're going to see him as he is, for we should be like him. My. He says, be diligent then that you may be found in him in peace, in fellowship, in communion. Because peace is the deepest kind of fellowship and deepest kind of communion that you can have with God. Without spot. And blameless. Tell that to the next person who tells you can't live without sin. God says, give all diligence that you without spot and blameless. And that's what those are the words that he uses to classify a perfect sacrifice that's holy and acceptable unto him that you can bring. It's got to be perfect. It's got to be without blemish. I'm going to tell you, I found this in Jesus, not outside of Jesus, in Jesus. I know how you can hear God say to you every day, well done, my good and faithful servant. Would you like to know? Yeah. Every day. You can hear Father. You can actually hear Father say to you, well done, my good and faithful servant. You want to know?
Yes.
Listen to him say it to Jesus, because you're in Jesus, and whatever he's saying to Jesus is about you, because you don't exist outside of him. So I just go read it. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Every day. Hallelujah. I read his word. It says, Peter said, we have a more certain word of prophecy that you do well as you take heed unto it. You're on the front row. You do well if you take heed unto it as unto a light that shines in a dark place. Are you listening to me? We have a more certain word of prophecy that you do well if you take heed unto it. He's talking about the audible voice of the Father. That's why I say, you just read it. Well done, my good and faithful servant. I'm in Christ Jesus. I don't exist outside of him. He is all my righteousness. He's all my holiness. He's my life. He that hath a son hath life. Outside of him, you're dead. He's all my holiness. He's everything that we have in him. Look, be diligent to be found in him. Be diligent to be found in him. In peace, in communion, in fellowship, where there's no offense, where there's nothing between you and God. Other than love and oneness, without spot, blameless. Whew. Right there, diligent. There it is. If you got procrastination, slothfulness, laziness, apathy in your life, lukewarmness in your life, you can't have this. That's why the Lord says, I'll spew you out of my mouth. Lukewarmness is one of the greatest violations against the grace of God that has been given us. Thank you, Father, for the Holy Ghost. It's just, he's red hot, fervent fire on the inside of me. Praise the name of the Lord. Whew. 1 Corinthians 12:31. What does the Lord say? He says, covet earnestly the best gifts. Covet earnestly. The earnestness, the desperation. That's a big part of why the woman with the issue of blood got healed. There was a desperation. She grew the worst. Spent all she had. She's out of money now. No physician's going to take care of her anymore. She's out of money. She's desperate. Now she gets hope. Then she goes beyond hope. Suddenly it moves into certainty. All I got to do is touch him, and everything that I have need of, it will be mine. His power will flow right into me. Yeah. Same holds true to you, for you tonight. Yeah. Hallelujah. And that's why Paul said in Hebrews 2:4, he says we must take all the more earnest heed to the things that we have heard, lest at any time we let them slip. We must take all the more earnest heed, all the more earnest heed to all these promises, all these opportunities. Father has poured out everything that belongs to the realms of the kingdom upon this church, upon you and me. He looks within our lives and he sees his inheritance, the capacity, the resources that he's given us, and we can squander them by ignoring them and pursuing earthly interest. What a great waste. What a great tragedy. There is a situation where the grace of God has just gone to waste. And the only result really that you see, as I read to you, is a root of bitterness springs up. Defiles many. Then listen to this one last verse of scripture, and then we'll pray for you. I just want you to know, I'll always remind you of this, that according to his divine power, he's given you everything that you need. According to his divine power, according to his divine ability, he's given to you everything that you need. He's given you all things that pertain to glory and virtue. His divine power. He's given you everything that you need. Everything that you need to walk in glory and virtue. But there's an expense. There's a cost. You can have the praises of men, you can have the praises of God. Huh? You can have the wealth and the riches of the earth, or you can have the wealth and the riches of heaven.
Yes. True.
Your life can be soon consumed with you, or your life can be consumed on an altar of sacrifice being offered up to the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I'm telling you, we're on the verge of. I walked in the Mac store just a little bit ago, Macintosh store. People started manifesting all over the place. It was crazy. I thought we were going to have a whole deliverance church, a deliverance service. I'm not kidding you. It was pretty wild. Yeah. And Father wants us to carry the anointing that way, where people are just going, just they're getting weird on themselves, and they're like, what's going on? They're looking at each other strange, and some jerks are going on. I love it. So yeah, tell me about this Mac right here. Come on, people, there's an anointing that'll shake. It'll shake people like leaves on trees. It'll happen again like it happened in days of gone by. Somebody's going to start being diligent. Somebody's going to stay in the anointing. You want a great increase in anointing in your life? You're going to stay in the anointing. You're going to stay ministering. You're going to stay preaching. You're going to stay fiery in the Word. You're going to stay fiery in praise. You're going to stay fiery in prayer. Yeah, and if you don't do that, you're not going to have nothing more than what you have right now or than any other thing. You're going to be marginalized. You're going to be just basically average, ordinary, everyday Christian. Father's looking for some people who will passionately pursue, earnestly covet, who will earnestly contend. And that this is the last verse of Scripture right here. The earnestly contend for the faith. Jude chapter 1, verse 3. No, it's Jude chapter 2. Beloved. Hallelujah. It's great that you get it, because there's some churches that don't even get that. They start churning. Just let them for a while. Just kind of turn the page. Looking at somebody else's Bible. I can't stand over there by her. Kita Nagashaya. Hallelujah. Jude 1:3. Jude says, Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you concerning the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. And if there's ever a time in history where God's people need to start doing this. If there's ever a time in history where the Pentecost church has upon their shoulders the responsibility to do it. See, people are just anesthetized. They're anesthetized to their conditions. People believe they're in Pentecost, but if they would turn the pages back and go and see what Pentecost was like in 1920, 1930, 1940, they'd recognize, wait a minute, it drifted far, far away from Pentecost. Don't even look like Pentecost. But because all they know is basically that which they have grown up in and that which they're familiar with, they think that they're full on in the move of the Holy Ghost. So I can say, yeah, the Pentecostal church moved the Holy Ghost to the back room. And now he can't even be found in the back room. And they don't even know what I'm saying. What? That's error. No, it's not error. While all the old men of God are going, boom. Direct hit. Or true. It's true. Now you have to ask yourself, do you know what Pentecost is? Do you know what the common faith looks like? Do you know the definition of the life? Jesus, he shows it to us, says, come follow me. Do you know what it looks like when the church is born and active in that which Jesus purchased? Acts chapter 2. All the book of Acts. As the church gathers together. Will you begin, and those of you watching me right now in the web or by YouTube, will you begin to contend and lay hold on the things and recognize and agree with God of that which he's placed in his church and the manifestation of the Spirit so you no longer be without them? The word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, the discerning spirits. To be without them, you should be grieved in your heart and say, oh God, show me, Lord, where I've grieved you, where I'm not cooperate with you, where I'm not walking with you as I should. He'll show you the working of miracles, the gifts of healing, the gift of faith, prophecy, tongues, interpretation. More than likely, all he's going to say is, you just don't refuse to be happy. You're just sorrowful and sad. You just refuse to be happy. Huh? And you're hectic to hang out with. You won't agree with me. How am I supposed to hang out with you? And you were looking for some, you're looking for some kind of secret hidden sin. No, just you won't smile. You won't be happy for nothing. I mean, what do we got to do to make you happy? We've done everything we possibly can do to make you happy. And still it ain't enough. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Because this really is what it comes down to, people. It's not hard. These aren't complicated things. You don't have to fast for 60 years, 80 days, 40 days. Just begin to do what God says in very simple. Amen. Put him first.
Yes.
Put him first.
Be in church every time the door is open.
Amen.
I don't care what. You got to crawl through the snow on your elbows. You get here.
Amen.
Put God first. Amen. If somebody offers you $10 trillion and 50,000 people are going to get saved, be in church. Huh? Put God first.
Amen.
And stay happy.
Amen.
And recognize what He's placed in His church.
Yes.
Look at He put the apostles in the church. Acknowledge them. Prophets, teachers, working in miracles, gifts of healing, governments, helps. Everybody stand with me. Recognize what God's doing. Recognize what He's done. People, recognize what God has done. Agree with what God has done. I was in the largest city. Some of you have heard me say this many times. You're going to hear it again. So you can start doing it. Start doing something with it. Hello. I was in the largest city in the world, Tokyo, Japan. 26 million, 27 million people. The largest hotel, 47th floor, looking at Tokyo, looking at Japan, having been to Tokyo, Osaka, and Okinawa for meetings, looking at the smallness of the church and saying, Lord, You look very small here and Satan looks very significant. What's wrong? 5 o'clock in the morning, the Spirit of the Lord woke me up and said, all heaven and Jesus said, all heaven, all power, all authority is given to me in heaven and earth. And I'm just looking for someone to agree with me. We've got to recognize what God is doing and agree with Him. We've got to recognize what God is doing and agree with Him. And quit begging Him and pleading with Him to do something that He's already done, because that's the height of doubt and unbelief. Are you with me? It's like an insult. You know what I'm saying? Oh, God, do what You said You already done. You know what I'm saying? That isn't going to, prayer ain't going to work. That's not the prayer of faith. So in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, don't conform yourself to the world anymore. Look at people who are modeled. Look at yourself and say, would I get kicked out of the Apostle Paul's church? The way I'm dressed, the way I appear. Would I be reprimanded by John and by Peter? And then go read, because you can read and you can find out. Well, yeah, I probably would. Then what are you going to do about it? Say, but these are different days and we're glad He's not around. Or are you going to change and recognize that God doesn't change? Say, Lord, I'm going to conform to You. I'm not going to conform to the world. I'm going to conform to You. I'm going to be transfigured. Isn't that great?
Yes.
It's, you got to conform to the world, but you get transfigured to be like Him. Isn't that beautiful? Huh? One's a yoke around your neck and the other one is a supernatural experience. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
People, God loves you so much. Listen, I'm so blessed by this church. I want you to take it to another level. Quit living like you've been living. Go look at yourself in the mirror and point your anointed finger at yourself and command yourself to change in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Then lay hands on yourself. Hallelujah. Pray till you fall out in the Spirit. Get over by the bed seat if you don't have any catchers. Amen. Hallelujah. Rise up and start moving in God. Start moving in God. Start moving in God. Quit having excuses about why you're not and start moving in God. Quit pointing the finger and start moving in God. Hallelujah. Adam says the woman says the snake, the snake's there. Quit pointing fingers. It's because. Just start doing it. Move out in God. Rise up.
Hallelujah.
Thank You, Jesus, for the anointing. There is not a person in this place. The Father is excluded from His greatness, from all the things that belong to heaven, from all the outpourings of the Holy Ghost, from all the great exploits. There's not a person in this place that cannot be a that somehow you're not allowed to be a Stephen or not allowed to be a Philip or not allowed to be anyone who would believe. The anyones who can do these works and greater works. Just let Him touch you now.
let him touch you now. Just let him touch you now. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. Jesus. People, what you do with your life will impact the meeting. It impacts the meeting. It impacts the church. It impacts the display of God's glory in the earth. If you just begin to become exceedingly joyful and happy and rejoicing, you become diligent, faithful with what God's given you to do. I'm telling you right now, there'll be a sweeping revival throughout the world, throughout this nation in no time. If all the church would be that way, in no time at all. No time at all. If this church would just begin to give themselves diligently to that which Father has given, supplied, oh yeah, I'm telling you. Satan will not be able to hold back the thousands and tens of thousands that will come rushing into the kingdom. Hallelujah. Just receive right now. Father has giftings for you. God has outpourings for you. God has refreshing for you. There's a wellspring there that should never quit springing. There's a river there that should never quit flowing. Be strengthened right now. Be strengthened right now. Be strengthened right now. Be strengthened right now in Jesus' name. Be strengthened right now by the Spirit. Be strengthened right now by the power of God. Be strengthened right now to walk in the realms of His goodness. To walk in the realm. Be no longer slothful. Be no longer weary. Be no longer tired. Delay no longer. Be no longer doubtful of a double mind. Lay hold. Lay hold. Lay hold, oh God. Lay hold. Lay hold, oh God. Lay hold. Lay hold. Hallelujah. Woohoo! Woo! Thank you, Lord. Thank you for faith. Thank you for joy. Thank you for love. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your mighty works. Thank you for your amazing love. Thank you, Father, for your gifts. Thank you, Father, for the great outpouring. Thank you for heaven. Thank you for the Holy Ghost. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for every good thing. Hallelujah. That pertains to life and godliness. God, according to His divine power, has given you everything that pertains to His life and His godliness so that you can continually flow in it
with a wellspring supplying continually this glory. Ha ha. That produces rivers of expression of heaven through Yah. Sayapaya Manea.
Tonight, I see in the spirit some who are slow to begin with, while others outran them. All of a sudden, I see them getting up and taking off and becoming faster and becoming stronger and outrunning those that even be out before, way out ahead of them. Yeah. Yeah, because this is what Papa does when you begin to wait on him. It's just like the man I laid hands on, all of a sudden he began to explode with a mature tongue. Just kind of got bottled up on the inside of him. Yeah. Don't you allow discouragement or anything else in the past or your history to hold you back. You listen to me tonight. If you could see the love in the eyes of Christ Jesus that the woman with the issue of blood was able just to imagine because someone told her. If you could see the healing power that is in Christ Jesus that the woman with the issue of blood just had a report of, and she got her so encouraged that she knew all she had to do was touch him, didn't even have to ask him about it. She could go sneak up behind him and grab what she needed and get it before anybody knew it. Then tonight you'd receive all that Father has for you. This glory's here. He is and he's here. Say he is.
He is.
And he's here.
And he's
here. Now I'm praying for everybody who wants prayer. Anybody needs prayer? Sickness in your body. Problems in your life. Turmoil. Just laying hold on things in the spirit. You want to run the race at a greater pace. Whatever. You just come, we're gonna pray with you and pray for you. Listen, I'm gonna come by you, I'm gonna lay hands on you. Hallelujah. And just receive. When I come by, just receive. Just press in. Just press in. Just press in. Just press in. Just take hold of what God has for you tonight. Just take hold of what God has for you tonight. Just take hold of what God has for you tonight. Hallelujah. Just take hold of what God has for you tonight. Take hold of what God has for you tonight. He's leaving nobody out. If you've never called upon the name of the Lord Jesus, I want you to hear me right now. The power of His name will result in the power of the Holy Ghost come upon you and change you. If you're watching me by web in the YouTube right now, or maybe you're even in here, and you've never called upon the name of Jesus Christ and been changed into another man, God's power there stands waiting for the opportunity to do just that for your life. All you've got to do is utter the most powerful name that is given in heaven and earth. It is the name of Jesus Christ. You call upon the name of Jesus, and Father said, I mobilize heaven, you shall be saved. I come to deliver you. I come give you a new heart. I come and give you a new spirit. All you got to do is want God. You want heaven more than anything else. I'm going to tell you right now, instantaneously, in a moment, you'll be changed. Call on His name. Call on Him. I break every power, every mind-blinding spirit, every power of Satan that is darkened and hidden away the knowledge of the Lord. Now, in Jesus' name, I set you free. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Get ready. Get ready. Power of God's going to fall on you right now. Be alone.
Be alone, Rama Mahaya. Be alone, Mama Rahaya. Be alone, Mama Rahaya. Be Sataromonde Aya. Makosi Arabea. Makosi Aramea. Makosi Aramea, Baromonde Araya. Irisitaro Mosata. Mondaya la Mosicara Mamatea. Zuturu. Zor Maman de Shepra Dananambra Seca la Maya la Mosoto. Beobra Fasaya. Mandosa Mahaya. Meosi Pekineshi. Meosa Tanaya. Morosi Predea. Manosi Begisha. Mandelo. Masatu Shinandaro. Moha. Moha. Meha. Mondosotika. Mayosotoka Mayo. Mayosa Pahata. Mayara Mandeo Sipa Andeki. Chapukuna. Mayeshi. 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 Moro Shipora. Mayosho Poshata. Mayosho. Maya sapuya si neka tantish. Marata pasata. Marata pataya. Sato, 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 sotarese. Sato, sato, rosita pahaya. Sato, sato, yola mokosi. Maraha. Maraha sei. Maraha seya. Maraha seya. Maraha seya. Maraha seya. Maraha seya. Maraha seya bohoya. Mayakro mohoya. So, mamania. So, mamma mia, vai rimandi, va sotto ronasito sinata pai. No, kininita ninishi. Those of you still standing, lift your hands towards heaven. If you're standing, lift your hands towards heaven. There's an encounter for you. God has an encounter for you. There's an encounter for you. You got to come out from the place that you're in and step over where he's at. God's got an encounter for you. God wants to touch you. He wants to minister his life, his glory, his presence. You got to step out from that which would confine you and hold you back. And recognize that he's removed everything that would be a hindrance. He's removed it out of the way. He's removed it out of the way. Sotoro mama. Sotoro mama. Sotoro mama. Sotoro mama must. Serimanda seya. Mambara de steya mambai. Receive. 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 The bastard. Receive. Meneste. Receive. Receive. Ekaso ke rashe koreneste. Receive. 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 Take it. Take the hope. Take the things of the spirit. Mambasa, take mambrade. Take that which God has given. He's given it all to you. He's not withheld anything back from you. Ha ha. Mahanahea. Don't be in doubt. Don't be in doubt. Don't be of a doubtful mind. Don't be of a doubtful mind, unbelieving heart. Borosi pranane prosite. Morisatarane exe. Mose, Mose metea. Mose minika. Mose minika. Mose minika. Mose manika paya. Mosi manika paya rasadeya. Marasadeya romositiya la lombosika. Ah, Ramamania. Father has so much for you. Father has so much for you. Father has so much for you. He has so much for you. All you have to do is receive. All you have to do is receive. Has so much for you. Papa has so much for you. Right now there's gifts of the Spirit. There's outpourings of the things of heaven. Right now there's a supply. I mean, his love and his grace and his mercy is towards you. Big towards you. Earnestly, he's pleading with you to receive that which he has for you. Just open up your heart and want these things more than anything else. Hallelujah. Haraba kiere de yeshia. Haraba bakishia rebea. Ha ha. Ah, Mane. Ha 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 ha. Ha 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 ha. Mane. Mane. Oh, wellspring. Ha greg, oh, grimoyo. Yea, wellspring. Yea, robo, yaramea, bosheka, mondeka, bayea, mahana, eshea. Spring up, oh well, within my soul. Spring up, oh well. Arise, oh Father. Let your enemies be scattered. Ha, Ramon, deceased.
He's here. He's here. You can lay hold on him. He's here. He healed any disease you have, any sickness you have. He's the healer. He's the one who's already done it. Just receive his wonderful gifts, his wonderful glory, his wonderful presence poured out, available. Just take hold of that which God gives. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So much of what Father wants to do in our life happens because we're not willing to remain the same. So much of what God wants to do in our life, it's just because we're just so hungry for Him. We're just yielded to Him. We'll do whatever. Come, O Lord, touch me now. Just let Him touch you. Just let Him touch you. He's here to touch you. Just let Him touch you. Just let Him fill you with joy. Let Him fill you with His peace. Let Him fill you with His love. That's how He talks. That's how God moves. His peace is supposed to rule your heart and your mind. That's how God ministers. His goodness, His gentleness, His long-suffering, all the things that belong to His glory. Hosinaya, His life, and in His glory. Marina manina bolono monia shitana. Monena manea maneja shia. Manea angolomoshikaya. Jesus. Jesus. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command that your eyes and your understanding be opened, that you may be able to comprehend the power and the authority of the name of Jesus, that you may be able to grab a hold of the love of Christ Jesus, participate with this love of God that passes knowledge, and be filled up with all of His fullness. To go from sorrow and sighing to joy and rejoicing. To go from doubt and unbelief to faith and confidence. To go from fear and intimidation to great boldness and certainty. Ah. Thank you, Jesus. Just let Him touch you. Just let Him touch you. He wants to touch you. Just let Him touch you now. Ha ha. Just let Him touch you now. Let Him fill you now. Oh, Ramamani, Siene Manu, Sikorini, Miamanane Mandoro, Miane Mene Mano Mandero, Zutana Mandebre Bebe, Alamangira Lono Mondoros, Gisana Nene Mandor Nandero, Si, Kiala Manane Menero Musi. Jesus. Jesus. Precious Lord Jesus. Holy is your name, Lord. Kiernamon Jessica Donomonsa de Deus is yet to la Manaya. Bieromosutan de Kisti Primamambre Bevedin in an end of Meshinga Lusana Sitia. Shiala Lamapando Recita. Jesus. Jesus. Brubambre Bekili. Just let Him touch you now. 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 He's here to touch you.
He's here to fill you. Just let him touch you now.
Come on. Listen, the Lord ain't going to touch you sitting there sad. He don't do sad. You got to do happy. You got to at least have your hand, if you feel sad and sorrow, we're going to at least have your hands towards heaven with a bit of a smile on your face if you want to really welcome him. Because he doesn't do anything but joy. So just do it. That's not as hard as... It was much harder to dip 7 times in the Jordan. It was much harder to go and wipe off the spit mud from your eyes in the pool of Siloam. I'm telling you right now, if you would begin to just rejoice yourself in the Lord, if you begin to enjoy his goodness, heaven will fill your life. Heaven's about joy. Heaven's about peace. Heaven's about good. Goodness. His goodness and his mercy. Jesus. You keep doing this, I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to dance around, you're going to get so happy, nobody's going to be able to contain you, hold you back, stop you. Here in this place, you will find... Here in this place, you will find that which will cause you, in this place that you're standing in right now, that you're sitting in, that you're laying in, that which will empower you never even to stumble. Here in this place, you will find that which God has provided us with, that we may be found in him with in peace. Hallelujah. Not having spot or blemish. This is this realm. It's this realm. It's not a something else. It's this. God wants this is that to be in your life all day long. Papa wants you to learn how to move with the Spirit. You're alive in the Holy Ghost. He wants you to learn how to move with the Holy Ghost, and this is what we're doing. Hallelujah. Don't be contemplative. Don't be sorrowful. Don't be sad. Be happy. Be glad. Rejoice yourself in the Lord. You're not going to change anything about your condition sitting there going, oh me, oh my. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Here's what the Lord will do for you. He will take a lot of time with you, as much time as you need, with a lot of love and a lot of faithfulness. But why protract it out there? Because what you're going to have when you finally get to that day of cooperation is what you could have right now. Ha ha ha. It's just really, that's just it. You say, well, I'm waiting for something that day. Now. Receive. Jesus aquí. Hadna ki ishiati. Hali manakea. Jesus is here. Jesus. If there's unforgiveness in your heart, then you have to repent. Don't be like Donald Trump. You have to repent. It's amazing how much, you know, I don't want to get on that subject. Just repent. Just say, Lord, forgive me. Release anybody else you've got a problem with. And get yourself over here into the Nemoshia. Because I'm going to tell you right now, you get lost in this glory. You can get lost in this glory. You don't have to look at me like that. You can get lost in this glory. Don't look on me. Look on him. You can get lost in this glory. I promise you, I'm not telling you a story. I'm telling the truth. And I see some of you being lost in glory, and don't you ever come back. Get so lost in the cloud of his glory, you can't find your way out. Hallelujah. Don't come in for just a little touch meeting. Lay hold on something in the things of the Spirit that's available here for you right now, tonight. You just can't lose it. You wake up in the morning, his glory is there. Now, if you didn't participate with him, it would diminish. It would diminish just by not being with him, just not by participating with him, because you begin to activate other things. If you sow to the flesh, you shall the flesh reap corruption. And also, if you give yourself over to just a realm of confinement, to just a mere human existence, that in itself right there is a prison. You know where Paul says you can come into the fullness of measure of maturity of the ministry of Jesus, or you become unto a perfect man, or you're like a little child constantly tossed back and forth. It's time to get tossing over. No more tossing. Heaven is here for you. Heaven's glory is here for you. The majority of you in this place here tonight, you should be able to so easily receive the things of God after having been so long a time around them. But tonight, make up your mind that you're going to continually give yourself to this ministry of the Holy Ghost, so that right here in this realm, you can begin to be moving out in the expressions of the Spirit. And the interpretation of those things that the Spirit of God utters through you. And a praise and a prophecy and a yieldedness that causes you to go deeper into the realms of joy. To be just lost in this celebration of being in his presence, where there's fullness of joy, and at his right hand where there's pleasures forevermore. Because some of you do not know the way in. You just don't know the way in. You're still stuck outside looking in. Just look, you're just outside looking. You might have a lot of knowledge, but a lot of knowledge ain't gonna do it for you. Just receive. Just be strengthened. Be strengthened right now by the Spirit in your inner being. I've got about 25% of you. There's about 25% of you. And those are good statistics for the church today. It's upper end. Come on, people. Come on, people. Come on, people. Come on, people. 100%. 100%. Come on, people. Ah, sakapapara bibitikish. 100% of you. Of you enjoying the presence of the Lord right now. We're going to do a School of the Spirit on Friday night, this Friday night, and we might just do How to Laugh, Introduction to Laughing, a fine art lost to the human race. How to be joyful when you feel like being sad. How to rejoice, simple little thing of how to rejoice forevermore, how to rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. How to give thanks in all things. Really difficult subjects. We're going to break down all, A-L-L, all, and things. We're going to make sure that everybody understands the full dimension and scope of things. Hallelujah. Ripata yerebehi. Hallelujah. I'm glad to see I'm getting more of a reaction tonight in church than I got out of Mac store. Yeah. Hallelujah. Probo si probo si paya. Probo si probo bo shia paya. Probo si probo bo shia paya ha. Probo shi probo bo shia paya riman. Probo shi probo bo shia mayan bedea. Probo shi probo bo shia la mananea. Probo shi probo bo shia mayananea. Probo shi probo bo shia manea tapunanai. Ibrima manasitist. Probo sitande le debexte. Probonde le debexte yendes et un roman chicanea qui en a capable. Que broma mon sedande le debexte. Tene mosheia. Tene mosheia. Tene mosheia. The realm of the Holy Ghost is a very real realm that you cannot enter into unless you want these things more than anything else. Heaven is a very real realm. Heaven is more of a real realm than the earth is. Most of our lives we've spent interacting in an earthly natural realm, and our distraction, just distracted, just all over the place. Just distracted. This thing, that thing, the other thing. People, there is a realm of heaven. that somehow I've got to help you understand is right there before you so that you can begin to live out God's plan for your life. To where it's not, the moving of the Spirit of God is not confined to the church building only. But it is in every dimension of your life. And when you, in the expression of what happens in the church building becomes, as it were, the highlight and the time to just, as it were, rejoice and celebrate in all the great exploits that God did through your life between the meetings. Jesus. Let me help you understand something, people, in case you don't understand this. Because I know every one of you are called into the ministry. The whole meeting is about the altar call. It's about the altar call. The whole meeting is about the time we preach and declare the Word of God so you can begin to move in the faith and the outworking of that which the Word of God declares. So many people think that the altar call time is time to go home. No, there's a real tangible glory of God's presence right here, right now. There is enough ability in this place right now for you to begin to move out and not be who you've been. For you to begin to move out in the things of the Lord, no longer be confined or limited to the normal existence, the everyday existence. Can I tell you something? Father's purpose, He's got an inheritance in you to change the earth, to change the world around you.
Yes.
Don't miss out. Sow to the Spirit. And you'll reap the things of the Spirit. The things of the life of the Spirit. Give yourself, participate with God. The greatness of God will begin to explode within your life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I know that some of you have to go, and it's fine. I understand. It's fine. But find plenty of time tomorrow to enjoy His presence, to interact with the living God who's very present, not absent, present. Just begin to minister to Him in praise and thanksgiving. Just begin to fill yourself up with the Word of God, Spirit and life, and let the things of God, just having your own service. Have your own meeting. And watch what will happen in your life. We must have a different kind of believer in the earth today. We must have true Holy Ghost people of God who know how to function and operate in the things of the Spirit. As God's described in His Word, if there's going to be any change, there's going to be any difference. If I thought that it would make a difference for me to move in faith and have enough money to support everybody so no one had to go to work, if I thought that that would really make a difference in people's lives, I would reach into that gift of faith. But that isn't what's going to change it, because then you would just be idle with your time. Because if you're faithful in few things, you'll be faithful in much. Yes. I just want you to take that which God has given you and the areas of time that you have to wait upon the Lord and do so. And watch what Father will do. Because he has the gift of faith. He has the ability to fully resource you. And all he's looking is for your willingness to cooperate with him. And watch what, Papa, there's nothing that escapes him. He knows when you sit down. And he knows when you rise up. And he knows your thoughts from far away. This is what he's interested. He's numbered the hair upon your head, collects your tears in his bottle. He's very near unto you. Lo, there's not a word in your mouth except for he knows it altogether. That's what he says. Trying to help us to understand how mindful he is of us, how attentive he is towards us, how open his ears are unto our prayer. And we're going to have to make a shift here, people. We're going to have to be so concerned with heaven and the interest of the Father that earthly concerns no longer matter. Earthly concerns no longer matter. So you take the things that the Spirit of the Lord has imparted to you, given you, strengthened you, and refreshed you in. Stay there. Get up in the morning and say, Holy Spirit, I want to move with you all day long. I want to be sensitive to you. I can't do this on my own. Make me sensitive to you. Cause me to be sensitive to you. Participate with Him. Begin to rejoice. Give yourself the joy of rejoicing first thing in the morning. Get warmed up. Before a singer goes out to sing, he does voice exercises. Get warmed up. Before you go out and engage yourself in a world who's set against joy, who's oppressed. Everybody's stressed out there. Yes, sir. Gnashing of teeth. Get filled up with joy. Stay there. Don't go. And then you go, if you look yourself in the mirror, after you look at yourself in the mirror before you get filled up with joy in the morning, then go look at yourself in the mirror after you get filled up with joy, and it's like, wow, you've had a complete makeover.